Good morning and welcome to the 28th meeting of Education, Children and Young People Committee in 2022. The first item on our agenda today is our second session on the National Care Service Scotland Bill. We will hear from two panels of witnesses today. Our first panel, I would like to welcome Louise Bussell, Chief Officer of Highland Community, NHS Highland. Nikki Connor, who's the Chief Officer and Director for Health and Social Care at Fife Council. Fiona Duncan, the Chief Executive Officer, Health and Social Care and Chief Social Work Officer at Highland Council. Just making up my list right. Vicky Irons, Chief Officer, Dundee Health and Social Care Partnership. And Ross McGuffey, Chief Officer, North Lanarkshire Health and Social Care Partnership. Good morning, everyone. All of our witnesses are joining us remotely today. The members will generally direct a question to a particular witness to get us started. However, should you wish to respond as well, can you please put a capital R in the chat box? The clerks will be monitoring the chat box, as will I, and we will bring you in when I can. Okay, thank you. Please don't feel obligated to respond to every question. If you don't feel that you have anything additional to state to what's already been said, that is actually absolutely fine. And also, if you are asked a question and don't have the information to hand, again, please just say so and you can send it on to us in writing after the meeting. We have a lot of questions to go round and ground to cover today, so we'll move straight to members' questions. And can I turn to my vice convener, Cocab Stewart, please? Thank you.
Thank you. Good morning and welcome, everyone. The Public Bodies Joint Working Scotland Act of 2014 aimed to better integrate the health and social care systems in Scotland through integration authorities. So my first question is, how does integration currently work in your local area? And what are some of the advantages and disadvantages of the model that's adopted in your area? Because I'm aware that there are two different models. So I think that it probably includes an answer from everybody here. I'd like to start with Ross, please, the Chief Officer at North Lanarkshire Health.
Morning. So in North Lanarkshire, we have got an integration joint board, and I suppose in terms of integration journey, it's been quite an interesting one. So we started with children and families as part of the integration board set up, and in 2018 that moved back into the local authority. What we reflect is that through that integration journey, we had an integrated setup pre-integration and pre-Public Bodies Act in North Lanarkshire. So we already had an integrated planning arrangement between the council and health board for community health and social care services. And I suppose the Public Bodies Act, in some regards, put us back a little bit in that journey. It probably paused us a little bit in that journey. I think there was quite a lot of introspection when the Act came in. And it probably took 2 or 3 years to come out of that and really start to move back forward again, probably get the ground rules sorted between all the partners and the new ways of working in place and the governance arrangements correct as part of that. I think the key part for me in terms of the success of the integration approach in North Lanarkshire is really about the whole system collaboration. So I think it's my best to, in some regards, lose what belongs to IGB, what belongs to council, what belongs to NHS board, and really try best to focus on what matters for the people of North Lanarkshire and how we best deliver that, no matter where it sits within that system. So I think we've got a strong collaborative system now in North Lanarkshire, all local partners fully involved. We've got a range of different integrated structures in place that support that working. And I think, I suppose my main focus on that really would be the fact that I don't think it's necessarily structures that lead to it. I think it's actually more about the leadership locally, the culture, the ethos that we have built up locally that really makes the difference. Because I think, you know, even pre-integration, we had quite a number of integrated services already in place. We had integrated planning structures already in place as well. So we can deliver these things, I think, irrespective of structure. And I think we can, you know, we can show that the progress has been made in North Lanarkshire over a long period of time in terms of shifting the balance of care and really come up with a more integrated offering for the people North Lanarkshire.
Thanks for that, Ross. Before the other panellists come in, can I just add on the next bit of my question, which was about how much money does your individual area currently spend on children's services? And how has this changed over the last decade? And if I can get a comparison between the change in outcomes as well for young people. So I'm looking at that impact, of course, of how much money has been spent, and what the impact has been on the outcomes as well. So let's have a look. Is there somebody indicating, or I could go to Louise. Louise, if...
Hello. Sorry, can you hear me okay?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay, so in relation to our services in Highland, we do have a significantly different model from elsewhere, which is really why we're here to present that different model. We have a lead in Highland. Can you hear me okay?
Just about. Yes, we can hear you. It's a bit intermittent, but we can hear you. We're getting fine, so carry on. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. We have a lead agency model in Highland, which means that we're not an IJB. We're the only area that isn't an IJB. We have adult services sits with the health board, and lead agency for children's services sits with the local authority. We have a system where we have a small number of services that sit out with that, our CAM service, but the primary care element of that sits within the council. So there are crossovers within the model. I think it was set up in 2012, and the background was that it came from research from across the country and visits to other services, including an area in North Yorkshire, integration in a similar way. And there was a feeling that this would significantly help in terms of that bringing services together. I think the challenges have been that for a long period, we didn't necessarily have the governance that supported the model sufficiently, because only in the last 18 months have we had an integration agreement in place that we're all signed up to and we're committed to. So we're working on the back foot a little bit in terms of how we get to the right place. The opportunities are that we do have a lot of our services wrapped around education. So there is a strong focus on how do we make the best use of health and social care for that education. Challenges are, if we've got part of the pathway in the board and part in local authority, how do we ensure that governance and oversight and crossover working? And I think the reality is, whatever system you have, it is that how we bring things together wherever the organisation has its focus.
And do you have any figures there, Louise, about how much is being spent and how that relates to the outcomes?
I haven't got the specific figures in front of me, but I'm happy to get those and send them across. I don't know whether Fiona Duncan's got some of those, because certainly the children's services sit primarily within the local authority. She may have them to hand, but I don't want to put her on the spot just in case she has them.
No, that's grand. I'm happy to have them.
Vicky Irons is keen to come in. Vicky.
Yeah, thank you and good morning. I just wanted to build on the information that Ross has shared in terms of the earlier stages of the establishing the integration authorities. And again, the circumstances in Dundee do differ slightly from Ross's contribution and indeed the lead agency model in Highland. At the outset, I was a general manager in Fife, but I subsequently moved to be the chief officer for Angus IJB and more lately of Dundee IJB. There was a decision taken by the authorities at that time that they would not be delegating children's services from part of the authority which sits with the IJB. So I currently am the accountable officer for adult services across health and social care. So if I can give you a very brief reflection on how that's worked. in terms of developing care services and our strategies for adults and older people, we've certainly seen huge benefits across the partnership in terms of integration. And we need to remind ourselves that integration was also aiming to not just integrate the provision of health and social care in communities, but it was also looking to integrate people's journeys of care across the acute sector and the communities as well. So we've benefited greatly from many of the specialist consultants that we have available in the acute sector in Nine Wells and Tayside becoming part of the Integration Authority and working hand in hand with our primary care teams, so that the journeys that are available and the pathways of care which we now provide for older people and adults are really very robust and very integrated, and do as much as they can to provide as much care and assessment in community settings and in people's own homes. So as I mentioned before, there was a decision that children's services would not be delegated into the IGBs across three local authorities which form part of Tayside. Many of the reasons for that are not dissimilar to what Ross has described to you. There was a fair amount of fear around the possible changes ahead, and most people were more wedded to the authorities and the organisations which I guess they had grown up with in terms of their professional careers, and so a wee bit dubious about forming part of a new organisation. I think we will see the same again as we move towards building a national care service. Many people will wish to stick with the arrangements which they've experienced so far. It does mean that the integration across children's services and adults becomes slightly more difficult, but I would have to agree with Ross that that's only difficult if you don't have robust partnerships present locally. And I think I'm very lucky from a Dundee perspective that because the chief officers are also executive directors of council and executive directors of the NHS board, we're obviously very close to our colleagues who have the authority to manage children's services. And as a result, we work really, really hard to make sure that partnership works. But we don't form part of the same organisation, so it does require quite a lot of effort. And it also requires quite a lot of effort, particularly in the transitions between children who are receiving care and support in their earlier years and when they move into adult services. But these are areas where we've worked in an integrated way for decades now, and certainly the introduction of the integration authorities may have interrupted that slightly with providing, if you like, new boundaries for us to work through. But I think we're all pretty much used to working with boundaries at some aspect. So we've tried to do that as successfully as possible.
Thank you very much. I've got Nikki that would like to come in, and then I'll go back to Louise because I think you want to come back in. So Nikki first, please.
Thank you and good morning. The experience in Fife is that we are also a body corporate model. Within Fife, I think one of the key differences is that we are coterminous. So there's only one IGB, one health board and one council in relation to how we would work together, when many of my colleagues across Scotland work with multiple IGBs within our health board area. Going back to the beginning of integration, there's a large level of services delegated within Fife. I think that brings huge advantage in terms of the opportunity to support that common vision, common purpose, and for the people who need to work together to deliver outcomes for people to be a team together. Within children services, in the shadow year of integration authorities, there was an opportunity offered and staff engagement took place regarding whether children's services within the council should be delegated or not. And I think for the reasons that Vicky had said, a decision was taken to remain within council services for the children's services and for criminal justice services. Within the health services, though, children's services were delegated, and they make up key areas around our child health surveillance teams, our children and young people community nursing teams, and that includes areas of integration, such as areas of residential care, home care, supporting out-of-hours nursing for children with additional needs. And it also includes our school nursing services, health visiting, family nurse partnership, child protection, our children, young people, occupational health, therapy services, breastfeeding and infant mental health services. What we have also, in addition to this within children's services, is that mental health services and primary care services are part of the areas that are delegated. And there's obviously a key focus within these services as well around the mental health and wellbeing of children. In terms of some of the strengths, I think there is a strength in being coterminous. I think that opportunity to be working together and, as Vicky has described, being able to sit within the executive team of the health board and the executive team of the council enables those shared discussions. One of the areas that we have done within the Health and Social Care Partnership in Fife is a recent restructure, and that was to bring a key focus of the services that require to work together. So our children's services now sit as part of prevention and primary and preventative care services, supporting and further supporting that integration with other health services. And we have a really robust community planning arrangements within Fife, which focuses on having a joint children's services plan which joins up with local authority. In terms of outcomes, we have been the first health and social care partnership in Scotland to be inspected under the joint inspection programme with the Care Inspectorate and with Health Improvement Scotland. And what was drawn out within that is the strength of focus on organisational development and culture, and also the restructure and bringing services together has been highlighted as a strength. And I would want to really focus on that spirit, which we would call Team Fife, where we work together, regardless of organisation, to wrap the best outcomes around the needs of children. In relation to the size and scale of the Health and Social Care Partnership in Fife, there are 600, and our budget is roughly £630 million, approximately 6,000 staff. Off that, children's services, the only data I have just now is that the budget for our managed child health services is £15 million. But in addition to that, we will have CAM services and other services that wrapped around children that I don't have the figures for today.
Thanks very much for that very detailed response, Nikki. Louise, would you like to come back in?
Yes, thank you. And I think, just for completeness, I wanted to point out that the NHS Highland has a second area, which is Argyll and Bute, and Argyll and Bute is an IJB. They do have a obviously significantly different model to Highland North, but there is also an interesting dimension in that in their scheme of delegation, they have all of children's services. And speaking to the chief officer for that area, she feels that that actually works quite well for them. But it's been made to work by having that really good governance, and similar to what Nikki's just talked about in terms of that, how we bring people together. So she chairs a children's oversight arrangement, which brings in education, which brings in all of the partners, the independent sector, etc. So again, it's much more about how we do things rather than necessarily exactly where they sit. There's obviously form and function challenges in whichever direction you go, but I thought it was just useful to share that we do have those two different models running concurrently.
Thank you. Thanks, convener.
And I'm sure we'll get into some of those complexities later on in the line of questioning from colleagues. But can we continue on this theme with some questions from Ruth Maguire, please?
Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. I'd like to ask about your integration joint board lead agency models and the difference that they can make in terms of accountability, flexibility and joined up services. But what I'd like to hear is, rather than from the perspective of your organisation, if you can give me an example of how the model impacts on children and families. And if I could go to Louise Bussell first, please.
Thank you. Apologies, I've heard the second part of that, but I just lost a little bit of sound for the very beginning of what you said.
So I'm interested in how your model supports local accountability, flexibility and more joined up services. But what I'd like to hear is some examples from the perspective of children and families in Highland, how that's working.
Okay, great. So I think it very much supports how we work very closely with education, health and social care at that level. The challenge is that at times some of our services sit within health and we've got to make sure that that pathway is clear. I would say that some people have a really good experience of
To interrupt, and it's quite awkward when we're doing the remote. I'm very keen to hear about specifically how it helps a family. Yeah. So you're still talking a little bit about the organisation rather than children and families.
Yeah, apologies. I was just giving an oversight of that before being more specific. So I think from a children's and families' point of view, I think the fact that they're able to have an experience that has all of the services in one area and one remit is helpful. They're not having to go to multiple sources. Okay. However, we do still have that challenge with some pathways. So I think, for example, our mental health pathway doesn't feel as robust as it should do. And that's how we bring together health and social care. We need to do that more strongly because they're in two separate organisations. But I think an individual will still feel that they having to go to two places rather than one within that mental health sphere. But if it's a child in terms of education, children's nursing in school, etc., I think there is much more of a feeling that the services are joined up.
I'm reading Louise. I'm reading Ruth's mind here. We're still looking for some examples, but if it's helpful, Fiona Duncan, who's from your council colleague, is looking to come in. So perhaps we can.
And I was just going to say it's probably fair to say it would be helpful for Fiona to give some of those specifics because most of those services sit within Fiona's remit.
The delivery sits at the council. Okay, is that okay, Ruth?
Thank you, everybody. Yeah.
Morning, Fiona.
Thank you. Good morning. Just to carry on from Louise, within Highland Council, the services of child's health and children's social work are delegated to Highland Council. So that is in my remit. So in terms of the work that's going on, I think it's a real advantage having children's social work and child's health together. That allows us to target things such as parenting classes, mums-to-be. They are linking in with social workers within the family teams. They are morphed into the family teams. So our health staff and our social workers work alongside. And the whole point of that is trying to get more towards the early intervention and prevention side of things rather than waiting until it enters into the statutory side, child protection, etc. So that is very much hands on the ground, enabling that to happen. An example which you might want, which is going to happen, which we have just been funded from in terms of the Scottish Government Whole Family Fund, is we will be targeting the Lough Aber area that has been agreed, and that is a multi-agency ask, and that is about ensuring that what we do have in that area is working effectively, efficiently and flexibly, because whilst there's some good working with families, we could probably argue that we're targeting children, but perhaps to the detriment of not supporting adults alongside that. So that's sort of some of the work that's come out, is we need to do both in order to maximise opportunities. You know, we're doing quite effective work with children, we're in the schools, we're in the communities. However, we also need to bring the adults on board with that and offer them the support that they need. So that's an active one for us just now.
And thank you, Fiona. How long has your system of integration been in place?
Well, that's been since 2012. That's when that came on. And unfortunately, this is before both me and Louise are both newcomers to Highland, so we didn't experience the previous system or being here at the start of that. We are very much the here and now and understand what we're trying to achieve.
So 10 years feels like quite a long time for a system to bed in. Do you think it's established now? Do you think you need more time?
I think it's a really interesting one for me, because you have a number of different aspects of it. If the way that it's been divided out and delegated enables, within my directorate, to make complete links with education, housing, homelessness, etc., welfare, that part of it. The bit that myself and Louise as chief officer that we're trying to do is ensure areas such as transitions is actively being addressed. One of the areas which is within NHS Highland just now is CAMHS, and that without doubt is an area that is not working as well as it should be, getting access to services within that. But that is we're actively focused on that just now.
I suppose if I was going to be gently provocative, I might say 10 years feels like quite a long time to get to the point where you understand that you need to support families as well as children. Am I picking you up unfairly, or what would your response be to that?
Louise, do you want to contribute to that first before we go back to Fiona? And I know that Ross is also looking to come in, but once you've picked up that thread, Louise.
Yeah, happy to. I think one of the challenges has been that we haven't had an integration agreement between the two organisations, so services have not worked sufficiently well enough across the pathway as they should have done. We completely acknowledge that, Louise, from our perspective, this hasn't been as positive for the last 7 or 8 years as it should have been. So Fiona and I are very much saying, OK, we need to fix this.
So who's responsible for an integration agreement between the two organisations? Why has that not happened? Louise?
That has related to the two organisations weren't able to come to sufficient agreement in the past around what that integration agreement should involve. It related to finance, it related to a number of factors. And again, the challenge is that Fiona and I have come to this since that time, and when we were already there when it was being more positively looked at, but there has been relationship challenges in the past between the local authority and the NHS. Those are, I'd like to say, very much in the past, and we are in a different space. But I think that's why it feels like that 10 years has not necessarily got us to where we should have been, because it hasn't been in a good relationship.
OK. I think that probably shows the need for us all to reflect on children and families rather than organisations. It'd be good to hear from some of the other...
Ross is keen to... From Ross, North Lanarkshire. Yeah. Ross, yes, over...
Yeah, so similar to my previous response, I think we had some integrated children's services planning arrangements in place for many years and predating the Public Bodies Act. And I think that, I suppose, on the ground, what that brings is that we have got a really integrated approach and whole system to try best to wrap around care around an individual and family. And I agree that there are still, without doubt, elements where we still need to see development. I think transitions is still an area that we have still got to try our best to develop in. But I think we can start to see some of the changes in that area coming as well. And, you know, even things like the national spec around CAM services being expanded today to 24 is another area where we can start to see that, you know, a bit of a shift in that pattern around how we can support those transitions and actually expand that time period where we can support a longer term transition towards adult services. I think that there is something here around the fact that it takes time to make really significant change. And I think, you know, we look at our journey around self-directed support in North Lanarkshire, we talk about the fact that, you know, it has taken 10-15 years to get to where we are now. It's not something that can be done quickly, and when you're looking at really transformative change, it does take a bit of time. And I think sometimes we end up getting to the next restructure before the one we're currently in, the structure we're currently in, has actually had a chance to really get to where it needs to get to. And I think that for me is, I suppose, some of the crux of this. I think there's some brilliant pieces in the Feeley review and really important aspects that we can absolutely get behind and go and try best to take forward. I suppose the question for me is whether or not that needs to be driven by a structure change, or whether or not actually forget structures and actually we could do more by just trying our best to get the right leadership and the right approaches in place within the existing.
Nikki Connor, sorry, from Fife, wanting to come in on this as well. Thanks.
Thank you very much. If I was to offer an example, then if I could draw on something within our children's services plan that we've been working strongly on. It relates to GRFIC in relation to children being nurtured, and it relates to emotional wellbeing. So work that we've done in Fife is together to develop a framework called Our Minds Matters. That has been strongly influenced by the voice of children and families to hear what mattered to them in terms of shaping this framework. And what that has meant around joining up services for children and families is more at a universal level for families. So what we have in place is a directory of shared services to enable families to be able to access information at the point of needing that. We've also implemented a refreshed child wellbeing pathway, which supports the identification of vulnerability and mental health services earlier, and having that as a multi-agency pathway so that we're able to, I guess the principle is no wrong door, and being able to support families at the point of when they access services. And then looking at when people need more intensive services regarding how we can support that, including both access to primary mental health workers, the role of health visitors, the role of school nurses, and also how they can be accessed to CAM services. So this Our Minds Matters framework has been supported and driven by the voice of children and young people and their needs, and the services working together to offer integrated pathways. I hope that offers an example of common purpose around a need for a child.
Thank you. It gives an example of the work that you're doing. I suppose it doesn't, what I'm trying to get at, and I'll probably start sounding like a broken record, is what does that mean for, if I'm a mother of a child who has difficulties, do I pick up your directory, phone whichever service I think suits them, and I'm plugged right into it? Is that what's happening on the ground in Fife?
What we're needing to do, what we're doing, is we're working together around what is the needs, what's the best agency and the best level to meet somebody's needs. And we have got pathways to support direct referrals. I was involved in a discussion this week where there was a referral that had came into CAMHS. CAMHS was not the appropriate service to be referred, but school nursing could have supported. And what happened then is a direct referral between services to support that family to get access to what they needed, rather than being told, this is not the right service for you, refer yourself somewhere else. So I think it shows an example of how we're aiming to join up our services around the needs of individuals.
Okay, thank you.
I hope that helped.
Thank you, Nikki. Do you have questions on this theme, Stephanie? You're okay. Okay, so can we move on to the next, with questions now from Stephen Kerr, please, on the general views of the bill.
Yeah, so what I'm hearing, what I think I'm hearing, if my interpretation skills, comprehension skills are what they should be, is that change is quite difficult to manage in your organisations in terms of integration and working together. I mean, I'm referring specifically, I think, to some of the evidence you've already submitted in writing. For example, North Lanarkshire talk about concern about the impact this bill would have in terms of a significant change programme that could cause partner bodies to look inwards for a period to address organisational concerns. Similarly, Dundee talking about changes that would create greater complexity, that would cause disruption in the working relationships you've already established. Am I interpreting this correctly? Can you help me?
Who'd like to come first? Maybe Ross McGuffey, and Vicky's got her hand up. So we'll go to Vicky first, she's got her hand up. And then, broadcasting, I confused you there. If we can go to Vicky Irons first, please, and thank you.
And thank you. Sorry, my R wasn't working in the chat, so I used the visual hand. Apologies for that. Yeah, so I guess some of those comments come from our experience to date, and although we're focusing primarily today on the last set of reforms and the forthcoming developments which are outlined in the framework for the National Care Service,
Many of us have been in similar roles for a good couple of decades now, and have lived through reforms in Scotland in this area twice before. And I guess the thing that we've learnt from that is that there tends to be a huge focus on structures and organisational change. And usually that process in itself can detract from the real outcomes that you're trying to achieve, and the outcomes which are envisaged and which underpin the spirit of integrated services. So I think many of us are cautious when it comes to further change, but also we're mindful that if there is an opportunity to reform and develop further, we'd like that to really recognise some of the constraints which restrict our progress at the moment. And for many of us, the fact that we have to deal with two different employing authorities, the fact that we have to deal with two very different cultures and structures, and integrate our teams within that, can often get in the way. Some of the other issues which we've obviously fed back through formal submissions and given evidence in other parliamentary committees includes the fact that because we are an integration authority which sits in between two public authorities, we don't have control over our own budgets, and we have a cycle each year where we have to go through quite significant negotiations and planning mechanisms to be able to set our budgets and then deploy our resources appropriately. So I guess certainly from my own perspective as a chief officer, and having been someone who's worked in this area for a great deal of my career, we would just hope that we can learn from the previous reforms that we've travelled through, that we've experienced, and not necessarily repeat those. And I think certainly when it came to establishing the IGBs originally in 2014-15, we were very, very conscious that the public authorities which make up the IGBs were reasonably cautious of change. I won't say resistant to change, because I don't think that's appropriate, and I don't think it's a fair reflection of the partnerships that were in place. And I guess what we're looking for this time around is that people embrace the possibility for reform and change and get behind it and make it work. So that's certainly the perspective from myself, having worked across a number of areas to date.
Can we hear from Ross? And we've also got Louise wanting to come in. Stephen Kerr, thanks. Ross first, please.
Thanks. Yeah, so from an off-financial perspective, I mean, I said at the outset, I think the learning from the Public Bodies Act coming in North Lanarkshire was probably quite challenging. As much as the fact that we'd already gone down quite a significant integration journey beforehand. And I think there's an inevitability when you go through a major system change that it takes some considerable time to get everything in place. And, you know, the governance arrangements around integration have been particularly complex to get our heads around and get in place effectively. And any reticence, I suppose, coming through in terms of the North Lanarkshire IGB submission is the fact that I think we've actually got a really strong system working locally in North Lanarkshire. So we work incredibly closely between the two chief executives and the council and the NHS board. We've got very strong relationships with our South Lanarkshire colleagues as well. So we see ourselves as sort of five organisations between the Council's NHS board and the two IGBs working together on this, and again with our wider public partners as well. So there's been a huge amount of work done around pulling together all the partners together within the Lanarkshire context to create what we feel is, you know, quite a strong system just now. And I suppose the reticence and concern is more around any unintended consequences of change and actually impacting on that. Again, I think the key focus here has to be on local leadership, local culture, local ethos, and how we go beyond boundaries to work together collectively for the needs of the local population. And it's that sort of place-based approach for me that really adds the value. And that's the element, you know, and I think there's a lot within the Feeley report that really focuses on some of that, you know, those elements. And it's how we try best to maximise those within our local systems. We, I suppose, the, you know, of whether we succeed or fail.
Louise, would you like to come in now, please?
Yes, thank you. And I think the challenge that you're hearing is that organisations have made work whatever they've got at the moment, and selling a good reason for change to people is always tricky. So that messaging around why we're doing something has to be really, really clear with our staff, with our communities, etc., so that we can make it a successful transition to wherever we go. I think some of the things that we've found that historically has been challenges around what sounds simple, but IT. How do organisations work across IT systems? How do we move people in terms of workforce? So again, we had staff that took it from the Highland Council into the NHS and vice versa. And that, again, often sounds simple. It's often more complex. So I think whatever we do, it's about making sure that we have a lot of preparation and planning and clear communication with people and really understand the reason for the journey. So I don't think none of these things are ever insurmountable, but I think it's the preparation is key.
Stephen, I was wondering, before, can I just maybe try and get the witnesses to think we're here representing perhaps the inclusion of the children's services, and I'd be really interested if we can have when you're commenting and answering these questions, if you can have it through that lens, it would be really helpful. But if you want to broaden it, please feel free, Mr.
Well, no, I don't want to broaden it. I do want to do exactly what you suggested, convener. And if I can turn to Nikki Connor, who's in Fife. Your evidence stated there is no evidence to including children's services in National Care Service, and the disruption that structural reform would cause would be of benefit to children and young people. That's a very stark comment to make. Would you like to elaborate?
Is my microphone off?
Yes, it is.
Thank you. So within Fife, what we would reflect is our strong partnership arrangements that we have around children and young people. And I've described that through us having a joined up children's services plan. I think what we would need to give consideration to is, I guess what matters is the ability for that to have that partnership, regardless of whether there is structural change or not that would take place. So it's crucial that we are able to work in partnership now, and it would be crucial following the National Care Service that we can work in partnership then again. It probably refers a little bit to Vicky's point around the changes that come with structural reform and the disruption that can cause. My view is that the more we can integrate services, the better that is, and the more joined up that is for children and for families. And there's areas where we could strengthen transitions. So if we look at children transitioning from children into adult services, as an example, would be an area whereby having our services across children and wider services joined together could help.
Well, that's not what the Northern Alliance said. In their evidence, they said the main risk of locating children's social work and social care in the National Care Service is that they will become a very small component of a large, complex organisation which has a predominantly adult focus. That's diametrically the opposite of what you've just said.
Yeah. I guess our journey of travel towards the national health and wellbeing outcomes is towards prevention and early intervention. So I would see the work that we do around children and around families has been absolutely crucial to the work that we do around integration.
Right, so can I have some comment from other members of the panel on what I have just said, quoting the Northern Alliance evidence, that children's services will be swallowed up and lost within the context of adult services.
Vicky Irons, you wish to come in?
My chat was not refreshing. Sorry.
Dundee?
Oh, yes, thank you. So that's not the experience of the health and social care partnerships we have in Scotland that do have delegated functions and completely integrated services across children's and adults' care. And I think a couple of my colleagues have mentioned some really important points today about transitions in care. I would also agree with Nikki's comments that I believe the best infrastructure you can create is one where you have a completely integrated health and social care service, which is across the entire life spectrum. That's because even if we're providing care which is focused on adults, as we are within the Dundee partnership, you can't provide the care for an adult whilst not being aware of their wider family circumstances and the needs of their children and other relatives as well. And the same goes if you're trying to provide adequate care for children. You really would benefit from a working knowledge of the dynamics and the needs of the wider family and the parents also. So I think, although there will be a legitimate concern that the scale of children's services may feel like it would be lost, that's certainly not the experience of my fellow chief officers that have that as part of their delegated authority presently. And for all the reasons that Nikki's mentioned around one of our main reasons for being established was to ensure that we were doing more work upstream. We were working on prevention. We were working with the nation's public health in mind. We can only do that if we can take a whole population approach.
So is that an argument for including children's services in the NCS, or is that an argument for the status quo?
For me, it's an argument for it to be all-inclusive. So that would be to include children's services in a national care service. But it's probably well known that I am also mindful that in creating a national care service, we have to make sure that that doesn't run as a parallel process and arrangement to the National Health Service. So my preference would actually be for a completely integrated national health and care service.
Right. I mean, so let me just ask you, stick with you, Vicky Irons, for my last question. I realise I've probably taken enough time.
We do have Fiona wanting to contribute.
Let me just ask this question then, yep. And then go to Fiona. I mean, so in terms of the bill, so the bill itself is an enabling bill. I mean, there's very little in the bill in terms of the detail of what a national care service would look like. Basically, we're being told that the powers will be transferred to the ministers, and then at some future point, we will find out the detail of what the National Care Service will actually look like in terms of its design and structures and so forth. Is that a sensible way, from your point of view, to make the kind of change that you've just advocated for, in part?
I mean, certainly, as far as we're aware from the framework we've seen, the next steps would be to open up quite a consultative process in, if you like, the design, the model for moving forward. And we would very much welcome that.
Do you think it's sensible to do it that way round? Do you think it's sensible to do it the way round the ministers are doing it, as opposed to us understanding what the implications are of a national care service during the process of the passage of this bill?
I don't really feel able to comment on that, so I'd probably prefer not to.
Okay, and
it was Fiona that's keen to come in again. She's from Highland Council, Fiona Duncan.
Thank you for that. I mean, I think the National Care Service proposal is not a panacea. And obviously, internally, we've been having significant conversations regarding what would the advantages be of bringing children's services in? And the information that we're aware of, the answer is not very much at the moment. We very much prefer not bringing children's services in. And I think some of the reasons for that is we have well-established and informed systems already within children's services, working with children and families. And probably our biggest link is with education. You know, education, early years, etc. That has taken many, many years to get where we are. And if you look at attainment, etc., they're all starting to improve. Being pulled into a national care service, education will not be. So therefore, they will be outside. So there's very much, for me, the social aspect of children and families, you know, whether it be education, we know that poverty, discrimination, etc., and disadvantage are very much at the heart of some of the problems that we have. So we need to target those, and that's where the early intervention and prevention comes in, with education, with welfare, housing, access to employment, etc. So for me, they're all the crucial elements that we have in working with children and families moving forward. Hope that's helpful.
Yes, that it is, and it's kind of the opposite of what we just heard from Dundee. Yeah.
Lots of views. Now, Willie, are any, have you got questions you would like to come in with, please? Thanks.
Yep. So we got a bit to the nub of the issue about what the real barriers are to progress, because I think everybody accepts, although they probably don't want, apart from Vicky, children's services to be included in the National Care Service, that there are problems. And the problems that Vicky identified was with regards to employers, two different systems, two different cultures. I would quite like to know from Vicky how that manifests itself. What does that mean for, as Ruth would identify, the recipients of the services? And secondly, from Highlands, as to whether you've overcome that problem of two different employers with the way that you've organised your services. So first of all, Vicky, and then Fiona after that, please.
Yeah, thank you. So it doesn't make integration impossible, it just makes it difficult, I guess, is the perspective that I would come from. So where you have a completely integrated team that both operate together and are, you know, based from the same base of providing care to the same people, it's just very difficult when you're working with two different sets of terms and conditions, sometimes two different policies from whoever the parent body is, whether that's the local authority or the NHS board. And you also have to go through, obviously, two different sets of negotiations when it comes to agreeing the resources and the annual budget, which is delegated to the IGB.
Vicky could interrupt. So it makes no difference to those who receive the service?
I guess it makes our system clunkier.
Yeah, but does it make any difference to people?
Hand on heart, say it makes no difference whatsoever. It takes longer for us to plan and redevelop our services because we have several processes to go through. But the ultimate aim of establishing the IGBs was to make sure that at the point of delivery, our services are integrated. So I would hope that we have behind the scenes worked through all of those, if you like, administrative barriers, and that the individual is now receiving much more integrated care.
Okay, right. Highland. Fiona, do you want to kick off?
Certainly. There's probably two areas to this. On the one hand, it's worked very well. We have staff within NHS Highland, social work staff who work there on NHS terms and conditions, etc. And NHS staff within my directorate within Highland Council delivering child's health. That's working well. It's not an issue. Where an emerging issue has started to arise is through salary scales. We have different terms and conditions. So what we now have is NHS Highland staff on higher salaries than what we do in the council. So what we're starting to see is people jump ship, basically, moving over. Now, that's an issue that we're looking for, looking at very clearly. But the other part is I'm a chief social work officer, which means I have statutory responsibilities for certain duties, but also social work staff. Now, I meet regularly with social work staff in NHS Highland, and we make sure that the professional links remain. The same within NHS staff that work under my directorate, they need links to the nursing advisor, the clinical nursing director. So you can establish those links very well, and it's not to the detriment of anything. So you can have both, but we do have an issue moving forward in terms of salaries.
Okay. So would any of these problems be solved by including children's services in the National Care Service? But I think Vicky agrees that it does. But does anybody else think those problems would be solved?
Nikki okay. Connor looks like she's moving towards her screen.
Thank you. Apologies for that. I guess the advantage potentially is a national approach to how we do things, rather than, I guess, the variation of 31 different IGBs and local authorities, as well as the different number of health boards.
So, Nikki, that's not what I'm asking. Would these problems that have just been identified by Highland and Dundee be solved by including children's services in the National Care Service? I know there's other potential benefits, but that's what I'm asking. Would the problems that have been identified this morning be solved by this?
I guess, so apologies if I'm not understanding, I'm not meaning to be, I guess it depends on what the National Care Service consists of in terms of how that is going to be implemented and delivered. And if that is bringing, depending on what that brings in relation to the roles around being an employer and other things, some of the issues that have been described there are part of what may or may not be the future.
That makes sense. So we don't really know what the National Care Service is going to really look like, because the framework model of doing this, and they've not really worked up the co-design stuff. But what I'm puzzled by is that not every part of children's services would be transferred, as Michael was identifying in a previous week's evidence, that we're still going to have bits of the service provided by other bodies other than the National Care Service. So surely we're just changing the line rather than solving the problem. If it was to be the case that you were to include, if you were to put it all under one employer. So surely we'll still have the same problems. It will just be different people in different places. Does that make sense?
I guess, I think within Fife, not having all of social work delegated and having children and families within Fife Council and having adult social work within health and social care, there is one chief social work officer, and we work very closely and we work well, and that's down to relationships and ways of working locally, but they are within the council. So there's something there about what does a National Care Service consist of in relation to some of these roles and that professional leadership, and to have all of social work together, in my view, brings advantage.
Vicky and Ross wanting to come in to Willie Rennie's question. So if we go to Vicky first, please.
Yeah, thank you. And very briefly, again, I think certainly what was intimated through the Derek Feely report, that there are definite benefits from having a completely integrated service. I guess the question you've asked there, though, is the National Care Service, as it's described in its current form, going to make any difference to some of the challenges that we've had to date? And the answer to that is no, not in its current form. Because in actual fact, what lies behind the framework that we've seen to date is a series of suggestions that even within a National Care Service, the employing arrangements will still be separate. It makes it very clear that the services which are delegated to the National Care Service from a NHS point of view will remain under the employment of the NHS. It infers that there may be the employing rights of the new health and social care boards of social care staff and other staff, but again, that still creates a division. And I'd certainly agree with my comments at the moment that one of the things which is really interrupting the efficacy of our working arrangements are the difference in terms and conditions, and the differences in terms of professional bodies in terms of what they're trying to achieve through their pay awards, which are also showing a difference as well. So if the National Care Service framework that's created can provide one completely integrated organisation that has all of the people working within it on the same terms and conditions as part of one public body, then I think it stands great chances of achieving something really significant. If it doesn't, if it has a hybrid model, if you like, of existing arrangements, then I think we will suffer some of the same constraints in terms of making things work.
So Vicky, I'm a bit confused, because you've provided a very coherent explanation as to why, under its current setup, current proposal, that we should reject including children's services. But earlier on, you just said you were in favour of including children's services.
No, it's not necessarily about children's services. This is about the efficacy of a National Care Service and the health and social care boards, which are described, which form foundation of the local organisations within that. And what I'm suggesting is, unless there is consideration of it being a body which can plan and commission services and also be an employing authority of all of its staff, whether that's across adult services or children's services, we're still going to witness some of the constraints that are present in the system currently. So I guess I'm talking about the current framework will have its disadvantages for adults as well as children. It's not necessarily about, is it a good idea to include children? I think it absolutely is. The issue for us is under what conditions, and if the conditions don't change from what we're operating within in the moment, there's a question mark for me as to why we're going for another series of reforms, unless we're going to genuinely work through the barriers that were highlighted in the original Derek Feely review.
Thanks for clearing that up.
Okay. We've got Ross would like to comment, and also back to Louise, please. Ross, over to you.
Thanks. I mean, I think Fiona picked up earlier, and I know it's been covered in previous sessions as well, but I mean, I think the key to success around children's services is the collaboration and integrated working across a whole range of different organisations and sectors. And I think the matter of where we draw the boundaries, they're not all going to be in. So we're always going to have to continue to work in the way we currently do to go beyond boundaries to support that. So whether that be housing, education, third sector, police, universal, specialist health services, etc. They all have to come together to work in an integrated fashion to wrap around the services around the family and children and young people. So no matter where we draw those boundaries, we still need to have that same, that same focus in a local setting, that we bring our local partners together to work as intensively and cohesively as it possibly can.
Okay.
Louise?
Thanks, and I think Ross has pretty much said what I was going to say anyway, which is, so I won't repeat it, but what I would just add to that is that I think from an organisational point of view, the simpler we can make this, the better. Whichever way we go, whether we go with children's within the National Care Service or not, we just have to simplify the way that organisations can and do work together to streamline and facilitate things working well, rather than put up additional barriers to it.
Thanks. And I have a question, I suppose, picking up on, we were talking about some of the issues with staff. Do you think your members of staff, well, they're not your members of staff, are they, in the IGB, but the people working and delivering the services commissioned by the IGBs, do you think they're aware of the pending workforce changes that are ahead of them as they're moving to perhaps change their employers? And also, what sort of challenges can you foresee when you're transferring property and liabilities from local authorities to the care boards? Who'd like to go first on that one? Can I ask Nikki to go first, just because you've got that one board, one council approach, if that's possible. Thanks.
Thank you. Yes. In fact, this morning we're discussing at our local partnership forum with trade unions, the National Care Service and the process. And we've been doing a range of communications with staff to support that early discussion and engagement that we will continue with in relation to moving forward. I guess feedback from staff is a bit mixed. There's some concern. We've just come through the pandemic. There's been a lot of change and challenge that we have been experiencing with others that think there would be real advantage and opportunity to bring things together. So I guess a mixed feedback in relation to staff. I think there's a lot of complexity around how we move forward, regardless of whether we are coterminous or perhaps the challenges around there not being. The future, as I understand it, is there'll be less health and care boards as there are IGBs, so there'll be a lot of change that will take place. But I would see from what you have asked, the negotiations in relation to what happens to other assets that are not currently in, there's a level of complexity of working that through. It's not something I fully understand just now as to how we would approach that, because it's not been a discussion as yet as to how would that be approached.
I can imagine some of the negotiations on the liabilities might take quite some time as well. Can I just leave that there? There's no one else indicating that they want to come in on that. So we'll move on to questions from Michael Mara now, please.
Thank you, Convener. And my area has been kind of touched on a fair bit already, but I'm keen to dig in a little bit more if that's okay, because I think it comes to the nub of my concerns and queries. And that's really about the range of work undertaken by social work and children's services, and whether the National Care Service would focus predominantly or too much on the care issue. I know, Fiona Duncan, you mentioned some of this already. Can you maybe illustrate for us the kind of the breadth of areas that your social work colleagues would be dealing with, beyond and including the issues of care, if you could.
Certainly. One of our key tasks is protection. And actually in the bill and in the Feely report, there's hardly any mention of protection. So that is one of our concerns that we've raised on several occasions. So child protection, we're obviously linked to all partners in relation to that. There's national processes in place, national guidance in place, etc. So there's that part. There's also your looked after child. So that can be everything from kinship, fostering and adoption, through to residential care, so residential children's homes. Well, you then have your early intervention and protection. So that's working, trying to work with children and families earlier before they actually hit the statutory side of things. That's very much the area that we want to promote. And within our family teams, as I say, we are all mixed in together, so we have child's health in there, so that's your school nurses, etc. The links, huge links, are with education, as I mentioned earlier, as well. You know, we have staff, both social work and school nurses, etc., in the schools, working alongside our education colleagues as well. So that's very much a part of our day job. Sometimes it's just families getting in touch with us. Sometimes it's about signposting, etc., making sure they can access the support that they need. So that's the key role of that, is about keeping children and families safe, first and foremost, and then really encouraging and enhancing and support them to achieve what they would like to achieve in their lives.
And for my own clarity on this, the individuals you have employed, the social workers, I know that some of them will have particular roles, maybe through care and aftercare, yeah. Some may be specific to it. But you will also have social workers who cover a wide range of these issues, people who are involved with... Yes, so it's not a case of those social workers who deal with care issues don't deal with these other issues. Is that correct?
That's correct. No, so you will have some people that... the caseloads are mixed. So you have to have a mixture of child protection as well as other things. The one area that we probably do is in the is we have a team for that, and the same with fostering and adoption. We have a team that look at fostering and adoption as well. So, but everything's linked. Nothing's standalone, and I think that's really key.
Okay, that's really useful. Vicky Irons, can I come to you then on this same issue? How would you envisage that those people who have those mixed portfolios, which is key to how a social worker is trained, it's how they learn their professions, how they're qualified. How would you see all of those functions landing within a national care service?
I don't envisage that being a significant issue at all, because all of those functions are also present across adult services in terms of public protection. And I think, as Ross maybe indicated earlier, even if you do have accountability for a health and social care partnership, which has had delegated authority for adult services, it doesn't mean to say that we don't actually have really quite an intrinsic role in the issues which relate to children and young people in our area of accountability. So I work very, very closely with children's services, with schools and education, particularly around the public protection agenda. And we're more than well aware that actually, if we have a public protection issue coming through children and younger people services, then that often is related to the circumstances which are present in adult services and families as well. So I can't foresee that being a difficult issue. I don't think there is a suggestion that we would be, if you like, drawing a boundary around children's social care services.
So the list. Sorry, if I can, Vicky. This is challenging online. You'll understand. I don't mean to sound rude, but the list there included issues of fostering, whole family support, kinship care relating to children, early intervention work through education services, and partnering. And they haven't. Yeah. I mean, those are not things that you currently do, are they?
No. No, but I can't see that being an issue if they formed part of an integrated health and social care board locally, because although those are areas which I do not have direct accountability for presently, they are still areas where we all work with a considerable amount of partnership across the existing partners which exist in my local authority area. I think Ross mentioned something earlier. There always has been present a degree of lines being drawn in terms of boundaries, in terms of organisational boundaries. But I guess the role of a chief officer and the role of an integrated authority is really to work in partnership across those boundaries. So I can't envisage a situation where we wouldn't still be capable of working across the whole remit that's just been articulated.
And you would recognise, though, in that your colleagues in Dundee City Council are completely and resolutely opposed to this change. The chief social workers, all the people who do this work, think that it's completely untenable.
I understand that there are reservations from most local authorities in terms of the integration of children's services into the new proposals around the National Care Service. So I'm very much aware of that. And I guess from my own perspective, irrespective of what ends up forming part of the new bill and the new organisational structure, I'm confident that in terms of our relationships that we have, you know, we all sit around the same corporate team, we can still make the arrangements work and work well for the people who actually need it most.
I suppose if I was to reflect on some of the frustrations you've already given, and you know, as a Dundonian, I certainly observe them, where the City Council puts money into the IGB and then takes it out to plug its own black hole, and you can't plan for services, and there are problems with the money. And I think you've expressed that really well in terms of the challenge. I mean, I suppose the model that you've kind of postulated around, would we not be looking at just replicating some of that, perhaps with a third agency involved? You know, if you were looking at bringing children's services in and there was to be a whole other budget that was put to that, or is your suggestion that we just pull all that together? And also, would you not think the logical conclusion of your model is to bring education into the picture as well?
Ooh, quite a lot in that, if you bear with me. So I guess there is absolutely a danger that if there isn't complete clarity and rationalisation in terms of the makeup of the new proposed health and social care boards, we are in danger of actually cluttering the landscape more than we have presently. And I think some of the views which I've shared personally as a chief officer, but we've also shared from the current perspective of the health and social care partnership, is that ideally we would be moving forward not necessarily with three public authorities that are present within the local landscape, but that we could move further and actually create a completely integrated health and social care authority. So I guess I'm agreeing with you that there stands a potential risk that the landscape could become more complicated. I think chief officers collectively fed back that we're worried that establishing a National Care Service as a parallel authority to the National Health Service may draw up new lines that we'd have to work through in terms of integrating our services. So I guess the issue here is what comes out the other end. And I would certainly advocate and support a system where we're quite bold in terms of our aspirations for integration, but that we make that clear, and we reduce the amount of complexity that's present at the moment.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Can we move on to questions now from Graham Day, to be followed by Bob Doris? Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. Listening to the views that were expressed earlier, and very much thank you for your candour, one couldn't help but, I think, conclude that this is a sector that isn't great at change, either culturally or practically. That after 10 years of the existence of IJBs, we're still not there yet, at least in some localities. Isn't that an indictment of the existing approach, at least in some parts of the country, and a reason to make the proposed changes? Because they are the only way of delivering a system that is consistent for young people wherever they live in Scotland. And specifically, on the subject of transition, if we're going to get better coordination, planning and cooperation, Can that only be achieved with an approach like the one that's being proposed? And doesn't it offer also the best chance of better integration of whole family support? And I would ask you, in responding to those questions, to reflect not only your own local experience, but the situation as you know it to be in other parts of the country, because I'm trying to get a feel for the overall picture. I appreciate your experiences, your locality, but you also are experienced people. You will know what the position is across the rest of the country. Can we start with Vicky Irons, please?
Vicky, over to you.
Yeah, thank you. And I think that it, well, I agree that there is scope. There's definitely opportunity if we explore the full potential of having a completely integrated National Care Service. I feel that although we have described a number of the disadvantages, some of the obstacles which sit within the way as part of the discussion today, we've worked really, really hard over the last 10 years to try and overcome those and still to deliver the outcomes that people need. And I do genuinely feel that there have been significant successes across health and social care partnerships, not necessarily just in Dundee or Tayside, but elsewhere in that respect. Given the opportunity, though, we would love to have a landscape that enabled us to overcome some of the barriers that were articulated in the Feely report, and also to have accountability and responsibility for planning and deploying the resources for entire families and the populations which we represent. So I do feel there's opportunity there. The proof is in the detail for me. And if we recreate something which makes the landscape even more complex in terms of accountabilities, employment rights, everything else, and I'm not necessarily confident that we will have learnt from the previous series of reforms in that respect.
Can we also hear from Ross McGuffey, if he's able to respond? Thank you.
Yeah, thanks. I mean, I think we have made, you know, I think reasonably significant progress through integration over a period of 6 years. And I think, you know, particularly where the pandemic through the middle of it hasn't really helped in terms of some of that, and in some regards has probably supported it as well. I think there has been in my mind across Scotland, a strengthening of integrated practice through the pandemic learning. And I think we're probably in a better position than we were 3 or 4 years ago across the country. It's difficult to really answer the question when, without the full level of detail in terms of exactly what the NCS is going to look like going forward, you know, particularly around whether or not we will see, you know, what health services would be transferred across, where would they be managed, etc., and exactly where the boundaries would sit between. I suppose I come back to the fact that I think we are on a journey where we need to get to much more individualised care, whether that be for children or adults, and get much more the ability to have conversations with individuals around, to be able to have trauma-informed practice, much more personalised self-directed care, and more proactive support around individuals. And I think that picks up some of the key elements there around transition as well. And to do that, we are going to have to, you know, make quite significant changes to the way we deliver health and social care services. And I don't think necessarily structures the way we do that. I think actually we need to try our best to have a look at different models and how we can try our best to make that work locally. A quick example, we had a session with chief officers and HIS a couple of weeks ago around human learning systems. And I think there's a whole load of the work around human learning systems that really pick up a range of the sort of key themes around feeling. But the sort of lead academics on that were saying to us that you can't structurally implement this, so don't bother with structure. What you need to do is just go out there and really start to change the way your staff are working, in small tests of change and build up from there, and then on a local setting, as you identify the structural challenges, then you can start to make some change. But to try our best to make these changes through a structural focus is going to be nigh on impossible. And I think that, for me, just tied in with, I suppose, and I think there's some great stuff within the Feely report. I think we need to get that real focus on personalised care, providing staff the opportunity to have much deeper conversations and about those professional relationships coming together to support people and wrap support around them, so that we can try our best to come up with the right answers to the issues that individuals are focusing on and are facing. And I think that complexity that every individual has around them, we need to be able to get into that way of working with everybody, and that means going across boundaries, no matter where we set the boundaries. And then, unless we come up with one single public service, then those boundaries will still exist.
Okay. Thanks, Kavira. So, perhaps be more charitable than I was in the tone of my original question. Let's come at this from a different direction. There's a sense from a number of things that have been said today, a recognition on all your parts that we can do this better. So, if within the proposals for our children's services and a national care service, there was a role for people like yourselves to bring your experience of the last 10 years or whatever to bear, to look at what has worked well, what hasn't worked well, what the cultural changes that require to be made, the barriers that you've identified earlier to be overcome. If there was an opportunity for frontline professionals like yourselves to bring what you have to the table and to develop a national system that reflected that lived experience, do you think this presents an opportunity to make genuine and worthwhile improvement?
Ross, are you happy to carry on as we left from yourself and then move?
Yeah, I certainly think that bringing the experience of those in the system together makes absolute sense in terms of that. I suppose there's a slight fear at the back of my head that by taking forward National Care Service developments around adult services with children coming on afterwards, if a National Care Service were to be formed and then this to be coming in as an add-on, I think there are real worries in my head there that we would end up with a governance structure that had been created specifically around adult services, and would then have to try best to shoehorn in something different. So there is an element here in my mind of we need to finalise what the decision is and exactly how we're taking this forward, but I would rather see that done once rather than in separate bites, because I think there is a risk there that we end up creating something that is absolutely focused around adult services. And I know, from the previous questions around how staff felt, I know with the experience of children and young people and children and families, social work being in both the integration board and out with the integration board, in the early days of integration, there was certainly a feeling that integration was absolutely focused on adult services. All our outcomes, our outcome indicators were all adult focused. And some of the, I think the children and families teams felt a little bit overshadowed within that landscape. And I think, by doing this in two stages may, lead to that same feeling again.
Would anybody else like to respond to that? Oh, thank you very much, Nikki. I saw your hand. Thank you. Nikki Connor.
Thank you very much. Very reflective of the question that you're asking, and the unique role and perspective that I think we can bring as chief officers. I don't think there's any other role that sits on both the exec team of the Health Board Council and on the IJB. I also, we wear different hats within our role. So in our role on the Integration Joint Board, we are chief officers supporting the strategic planning. But in our role as directors on the executive team, we have also got the responsibility for delivery. And there's something for me really important around that role, as clunky as it sounds, around that glue that helps to glue and support and join up our systems together. So I think in terms of sharing our experience, that part of your question, I think there's a lot to be offered. I think there's also learning across our system of how things have been approached within, whether it be children's services or adults. So we have just put ourselves forward to be a potential Pathfinder site in relation to Gerthy, and so getting it right for everybody, and the principles and the values by which children's services would work, and my experience of having some children's services delegated is a real strength in how we could approach and achieve the outcomes for adult services too. One of the things I would reflect on as well, though, is that the current legislation enables the delegation of elements of children's services, and what we have across Scotland just now is variability and how that legislation has been applied through the choice of different age areas through their integration scheme. So, again, that would make me reflective around structure to make the change happen. And I would highlight what I said at the beginning around within Fife, there are really good relationships, and we work well as a team across the agencies. Regardless of what reform comes, I'm not sure I can envisage there being less than one health board, one health and social care board, and one council within an area such as Fife. But across Scotland, I think there is more variability and probably significant impact and change.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Can I move to questions now from Mr. Bob Dorris, please?
Thanks very much, convener. It's been a really interesting evidence session. Can I get questions on two themes? But both are around what the opportunities could be of a national care service. And I note that there are concerns that have been raised today, but this may happen. So it's about what the opportunities may be. So the first part is on the national care service charter that's contained within the bill. And there were some concerns raised about whether the care service will focus too much on adult care and not deal enough with children, young people, families and child protection and that kind of thing. Does anyone want to maybe comment about what the opportunities could be to shape that charter to set out what our ambitions and aspirations are for the wider childcare services in Scotland, designed nationally but delivered with flexibility locally? So what are the opportunities? Any of you given thoughts to the National Care Service Charter and what the benefits of that could be?
I'm looking for someone willing to go first on that one. Perhaps, can I go to Louise Bussell up in Highland, please?
Yeah, absolutely. I think some of the opportunities are, as I mentioned earlier, the simpler we can make this, the better. So if we can make something that has a seamless service for people from almost cradle to grave, if you like, as we try to do with the NHS, I think it's helpful. So people really understand where they're going for services, what those services will look like, and how they interrelate with other parts of the system. So if we've got one model across the whole of Scotland that works in a very similar way, that helps everybody understand exactly what we've got and how we're doing things. I think also having that journey, people moving from children's services to adult services, we've mentioned quite a lot today already about transitions, and having that opportunity for transition within a single system instead of handoffs, as we often have in service lines, unless we've got that pathway right. But I think that simplification and streamlining of how we do things. But again, as others have mentioned, we've still got to make sure that the cross relationships are there between health, National Care Service, education and independent sectors. So there's still a requirement to make sure that those lines are right for what we need to do. But again, that simplification of how we're doing pathways, I think, would be...
Okay. Can we perhaps go to Ross or Fiona?
Yeah, so again, I mean, I think we've got a lot of the, real building blocks already in place in Scotland. And I think, just reflecting on some of the positives, whether it be through GIRFEC or, the progress around the promise, I think we've got, some real positive building blocks in place. And I think the key tip for me here is actually probably a bit of trust and belief in some of the positives that we've actually got in development, and really try our best to get all efforts behind following them through. And I think that in local systems, the importance for me is how we all work together collectively as local partners. And as I keep saying, for me, it's about making sure we're doing the right thing for in my area, the children and young people of North Lanarkshire and the families of North Lanarkshire. And I think if we can maintain that focus across our local partnerships, you know, with the positive direction of travel we've got, I think we've got a lot of the building blocks already in place there, you know, to actually make some significant change over the couple of weeks.
Okay, Mr. McGuffey, that's helpful. I mean, I asked a similar question last week, and I think the witnesses last week have maybe taken a similar approach to witnesses this week, which is understandable, which is everyone's focusing on what structural change may look like rather than what the potential opportunities may be of this change. And just for putting on the record, the National Care Service Charter is an opportunity to draw in the one place a summary of the rights and responsibilities that all of us have within the National Care Service and for children and for families. So maybe not for answering today, but if any of the witnesses think that there are some opportunities in relation to that, perhaps you could pass it to the committee by email to the clerks, because this may happen and we want to make sure those opportunities are realised. Now, my second line of questioning was in relation to kinship care. And just to give an example, in May this year, there was a national kinship care protocol brought in across all local authorities. And it was cluttered and it was complex and it was difficult. Some of the accusations that have been made about a potential new National Care Service involved COSLA, SOLAR, Social Work Scotland, Chief Social Work Officers Working Group and the National Kinship Care Collaborative. And that was attempts to have a national coordination to kinship care, which are absolutely welcome. But Nicky O'Connor spoke about that variability across Scotland for various services, and we still have a situation where kinship care allowances vary across 32 local authorities. Access to trauma-informed care for young people varies across 32 local authorities, and placements in bereavement, for example, so when a kinship carer volunteers to take a child or is placed by social work, can determine whether you get that allowance. There is significant national variability, so are there opportunities within a national care service delivered locally to address that national variability? And I would quite welcome any comments in relation to children and looked after children.
Who would you like to respond on that for you?
Given the fact that Nicky O'Connor spoke about variability across the country, perhaps Nicky would be an ideal person to come in about how we could deliver better, potentially, with the National Care Service for kinship carers and looked after children and their families.
Thank you.
Thank you. So there's something there about, I guess, national framework and local delivery, as you've described, and the opportunity potentially around single governance frameworks and to reduce the potential in relation to some variability, so long as there is the flex that we deliver locally. In terms of my responsibilities just now, it is only health services for children that are delegated. But what we have in place with some of our adult services is we've got shared lives, and we have got support for adults at need or in terms of protection. And I've got mechanisms in place there, which I guess go back to a legislative framework nationally around protection. In terms of some of the benefits, though, and if we look at looked after children, some of the work would be that can happen across the agencies. And I guess I would highlight it already does happen around health needs assessment beginning to come together to be able to support locally the joined up across the agencies in terms of meeting the needs of those individuals. And for example, just now, referrals would be into our health services, whether that be across our school nursing services, to ensure that they are concluded and then they inform and we ensure the voice of children are heard within the assessments that take place to best meet their needs. So I think that happens already in relation to how our services would join up with the unique contribution of each of those services.
Nicky, I could ask you a little bit more about that, if that's okay, and apologies again, it's so difficult when it's an online session like this. So I commend the really good work that's happening locally. I suppose my point would be the work that's happening locally in Glasgow will be different from Gallows Shields, which will be different from Aberdeen and Aviemore. It's making sure we get more national consistency. We've been hearing for many years about benchmarking and sharing best practice, but decades later, that hasn't necessarily happened. So can this help address that variability?
And we've also got Fiona from Highland, keen to contribute, Bob, as well. Bob Doris, sorry. Thanks. Yeah.
Thank you. Just to see that we have... Chief Social Work Officers have for many years asked for a national agreement in terms of fees and allowances for kinship, fostering and adoption. Now, I know that's been discussed for a long time. One of the reasons for that is it can sometimes be portrayed that the child has been a bit of a pawn here in terms of what gets paid and what doesn't, and that shouldn't be the case. There hasn't been, I think we were expecting, I think the fostering one to come forward quite soon, but I think that's been delayed. I actually, personally, I don't think you need a national care service to come to that agreement. I think if you asked across the board, would we want a nationally agreed fees and allowances, the answer would be yes. Okay. So could we actually achieve that in another way?
So there's maybe more than one way to achieve that, but a national care service may be a way, but it's not the only way. My final question, convener, may be directed to Ross McGuffey, because it widens out Fiona Duncan's point. It's not just about the allowances that are paid to support kinship care children and their families, it's about the access to wider services, and there's quite significant variability across the country in relation to that. And Ross McGuffey talked about trauma-informed care and support, which he was absolutely right to do. I've got a centre of excellence dealing with trauma-informed care for kinship carers based in my constituency. They get funded via commissioning basis, sometimes from integrated joint boards, sometimes from local authorities, sometimes from NHS Direct, across a number of local authorities. And it's a mishmash of funding, which makes them really struggle with sustainability. So in terms of commissioning specialist services that is trauma-informed for very vulnerable children and young people, could there be an advantage in relation to a national care service to delivering better in relation to that?
I certainly think that there are elements in there that we can do to try best to bring stability to services. So I think in terms of our commissioning approaches, you know, I've got local examples, probably more focused on adult services, but you know, we've got things like a 10-year framework for self-directed support providers and care at home providers that, you know, the whole aim of that was to try to bring a degree of stability to the sector that had previously been 2 or 3 year agreements that we had been able to provide. But I think there is certainly something there around sustainable commissioning that we can look at to try our best to provide that sustainability. And I think obviously every individual area has got its own mix of providers and opportunities, and you know, some elements will be in-house in some local authority areas and partnership areas will be, you know, in-house or extra provisioned elsewhere. So I think there are certainly elements that we can do in terms of commissioning, both in terms of national frameworks and local frameworks that can make a difference on that. And I think, again, I think that's an area that we can do irrespective of structure. I think that you know, that's an area we can certainly can continue to develop. And I know the Feely report was, you know, very strong in terms of the importance of ethical commissioning. And it's something, you know, in our own local partnership, as part of that development we were visited to talk to, the work we've done locally around ethical commissioning and the impact that we've been able to have in terms of that stability.
Thank you. I'll leave it there. Thank you.
Thank you, Bob. Now, Stephanie Callaghan, you have a supplementary on this theme.
Yes. Thanks very much, convener, and thank you, panel, for being here today. If I can direct this to Vicky, first of all, and of course you're all welcome to come in. We've talked a lot about consistency and quality, and we've highlighted quite a lot of challenges to joint working, but talked about the real improvements as well in partnership working that have been grown. And we've heard that the key to success really is collaboration that improves outcomes. So going back to Derek Feely's recommendations, central to that was an NCS with a co-design aspect that looks to fully involve not just social workers and health professionals, but also those receiving care and the organisations that support them. So adults, children's, families, third sector, advocacy, disabilities. And these recommendations were in response to overwhelming public support to see that. So looking to care boards that include members with lived experience as well as social workers, health professionals, etc. Is that not an opportunity to expand on the success of joint working to include those with lived experience in the ongoing design and delivery of services going forward to make sure that we're delivering the outcomes that matter most to people, not just now, but in the future as well? So surely it's about
that collaboration, bringing in that lived experience, actually adding to the collaboration that you've got and making things better. Thanks.
Who's the question directed to, Stephanie?
I said Vicky. Sorry,
oh, sorry,
initially.
Didn't you?
Yeah. Yeah, thank you. And absolutely couldn't agree more that to bring in not just that lived experience, but actually to co-produce and coordinate the care that's provided, I think is a huge opportunity in terms of any reform moving forward. We do presently within the IGBs have engagement from carers' representatives. We have actually quite an extensive network of individuals with lived experience in the families and carers of those who are experiencing our care as part of our strategic planning approach that was set out in the original bill. But I think there's a huge opportunity to take that much further forward. And one of the main reasons I think that that presents us with an opportunity is I think it's becoming very, very clear in terms of the sheer volume of demand for our services that we need to create the capacity to care across all of our communities. And we need to start thinking about doing that through partnerships. So this isn't just about a statutory service response. It is about what can be developed, what can be delivered, what can be supported within people's own communities across unpaid carers, around the third sector, around our independent providers and the statutory services that would form part of the new National Care Service. So, and I think it's very clear from the Derek Feely report that we have to look at our services through the lens of the people that need our services and need our support. So we would genuinely welcome the opportunity for that to become a driving force in the new organisations.
OK, thank you. On that, Vicky, I suppose the Derek Feely report gave no indication at all of the inclusion of children's services, and it did come as quite a surprise for it to be here today. But, and you spoke briefly about the co-production of services there. So I'm trying to ask you a little bit, given that the co-production is probably going to happen after the legislation might come into play, can you not foresee that being a challenge? And I think Ross alluded to it being bolted on earlier on. Can you not, that sort of cart before horse aspect of this bill at the moment, Vicky?
Yeah, I mean, and I agree with Ross's comments. I think that will provide a huge challenge for us when it comes to adapting to change. One of the most important jobs for people in the roles that we hold as chief officers is enabling people to change and taking people with us when it comes to moving forward and developing. And if you're going to do that in a staged approach, I think that that does potentially present some issues. And I'd probably just agree with Ross's comments that from the perspective of chief officer, if we're going to go for really quite radical reform that are in the interests of the people that we want to provide care for in a sustainable way, it would be better from our perspective to do that once.
Thank you. Fiona wants to come in on that point as well. Thank you, Fiona. Over to you.
Thank you. I just feel at this point that we had, as you will be fully aware, the Promise, who have reported significantly on, in the first instance, on our looked after children, and the whole idea about the structure needs changed. And that's everybody in every organisation. And they, after meeting thousands of young people, pulled together the Promise documents, which are ongoing, and a 10-year plan. And that, I think, gives you a really good indication of change is required, but also where it needs to go. And there's things within that that nobody disputes, if it's for the welfare of the child as we move forward. It's always been my understanding when we talked about the National Care Service is that as well, it's almost as if the process outlined in the Promise can or could be used within the National Care Service as that is to progress. I know it says it's a 10-year plan, but I think it articulates the intricacies that are involved and the different parts that are involved in the system. And it may be helpful at some point to bring that onto the table. But I think, again, it perhaps articulates that that is But that is ongoing. That is running in, as we speak alongside the National Care Service.
Thank you. And we heard some evidence from them last week. So can I hand over now to Michael Mara, please? Thank you, Michael.
Thanks, Convener. So this is a very major change that we're being asked to pass in a framework bill. You understand, we're essentially approving it in principle, and then the model will follow afterwards. And I recognise that that's a challenging thing to then imagine what that process might look like after the event. We've just touched on the promise and the Feely review. Can I ask what evidence the witnesses have seen marshalled to support the change that we've been asked as a parliament to approve? What's the evidence base for the moving of children's services that you've seen? Can I start with Ross, please?
So, I don't know I've seen a great deal. I mean, I think I certainly listened to previous sessions, and the Inspector were quite clear that we've got some areas with children's services delegated to IGBs that have been positive in terms of the Inspector report. And others that have been not so positive, and vice versa for those who don't have a delegated. So I'm not sure I've seen any concrete evidence, but I suppose I think the process that came out the back of that was to build that evidence base and to review that evidence base to make the decision.
Okay, thank you. Nikki, have you seen a marshalled evidence base to support this change?
Thank you. Apologies. Can you hear me?
Okay.
Yes. Thank you. I've not seen a specific evidence base other than the discussions I've had locally regarding the advantages. The evidence that I would say I have seen is that there's a strong evidence base that the more services are together, the more they're integrated, the more we can join up outcomes for individuals. That does not relate specifically, though, to children's services.
Okay. Thank you. Vicky? Okay, have you seen a marshalled evidence base? I mean, we've just heard the Feely review was about adults' care. So, Vicky Irons, have you seen a marshalled evidence base about the transfer of children's services?
No, none in addition to those that have been referenced by my colleagues.
Okay. Who have I yet to get to? Highlands. Louise?
As others have said, I haven't seen an evidence base other than the need for us to have things as aligned as possible, wherever that ultimate outcome is. But I haven't seen any evidence for this specific move.
And Fiona, do you think we should be following evidence-based policymaking? Have you seen any evidence?
We should be following evidence-based, and no, I haven't seen any evidence based on this. Thank you.
Thank you, Kambira.
Okay, thank you very much. And we have a wee bit longer if anyone wants to ask any further questions. If not, we can conclude the session early. I've got nodding heads. Okay, can I thank the panel for your time today and for responding to our questions. It was very informative. We are now going to suspend the meeting for 15 minutes. Is that correct? 15 minutes. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Broadcasting. Okay, welcome back. And we are now going to take evidence for our second panel today on the National Care Service Scotland Bill. Can I welcome to the meeting Martin Crewe, who's the Director of Barnardo Scotland, and Jude Curry, Chair of the Scottish Association of Social Work. Good morning, both. Thank you for joining us. Our session is hybrid. On this panel, Jude Curry is participating virtually. So, Jude, as you won't be able to catch my eye, when you want to come in, can I ask you put a capital R in the chat box when you wish to speak, and the clerks will be monitoring the chat box, and we'll bring you in when you can. And let's move straight to members' questions. And can we start off this after the second session with Stephanie Callaghan, please?
Thank you very much, Convener, and welcome to the committee today. So I suppose a question for both of you. Has integration led to a more collaborative working right across the public sector and between them and third sector organisations? And has that helped improve outcomes for children and young people? We start with Martin.
I mean, the brief answer is probably no. As with a lot of implementation, it varies across Scotland, and in some places it's made a bit of a difference, but for most of our work it's not made a great deal of difference.
Jude, would you like to respond now, please?
Yes. I guess I would say the picture is very mixed. Certainly, I think the variety of experiences of our members, which will be very broad because they will exist in very different setups. We're here, obviously, I'm speaking on behalf of social work members today. We always will work and strive to do best practice. And that has been mentioned, I think, by Mr. Doris last week in terms of the workforce, regardless of structures, we will always try to work in productive multi-agency ways, particularly as children and family social workers. Trying to harness a multi-agency group around a child and a family. But we can be better social workers and offer better social work, I think, if we have the enabling conditions and the environment to help us do that work. So I would say what we could speak to are the conditions that we need and the mixed conditions, I think, that we experience across the country.
Thank you. And can I just ask then, going back to yourself, Martin, then, do you believe then that the National Care Service presents an opportunity then for third sector organisations, as well as people with lived experience, to actually be right there in the centre of care boards and to be part of that co-design process to look at new policy and look at the delivery so that people are getting the outcomes that matter to them?
The area that I can speak to is about the inclusion of children's services in the National Care Service. I mean, as far as I can tell, the Feely report is a good report on adult care. It doesn't look at children and young people. And I suppose, I'm not opposed to the inclusion of children's services, but I think the key point is it going to lead to better outcomes? And at the moment, I would say I'm not convinced. And, you know, just the level of upheaval here, I mean, I know the committee's looked at college reorganisation, and I was on the board of Edinburgh College and its predecessor, Stevenson College, and just the amount of upheaval that change took, which is small compared to introduction of the National Care Service. So, you know, almost inevitably any change of this sort takes longer, costs more, and is more disruptive than people thought. I think on the specific here of children's services, I think what we're looking at is, does it make the interfaces between different parts of the system easier? And, you know, Barnardo's works across a whole range of different children and young people support. I think the area where, if you said, OK, well, an ideal National Care Service would potentially have better interfaces with health and with adult social care, so how would that impact on our work? I think the area where I could see potentially it could be good is particularly for older children with learning disabilities, where that transition into adult care is a really difficult one. So I could see that as a potential benefit. But, you know, I know some of the previous evidence you've heard, there's an awful lot of other children and young people, and a national care service would either not affect those interfaces or might even make them more difficult. So just take three examples. First of all, you know, for most children, the key interface is education. For children who've been abused, key interfaces are around police and children's reporter system. And for care leavers, the key interfaces are around housing, colleges, education, employment support. So for large numbers of the children, families and young people we work with, I can't particularly see that National Care Service would have a big positive impact.
OK, so you've talked a bit about the challenges there. Can I just ask you as well about, we heard from Ross McGuffey earlier on in the session today as well, about those concerns that if we have adult services as part of the National Care Service, that actually having children's services sitting out with that could create problems with the approach to whole family support. I think he spoke as well about it being something that perhaps you would look at shoehorning in later to a system that's surely built around adult services. So just wondering what your thoughts were on that.
Yeah, I mean, I think there's a danger being either in or out of it, but the fact that we're included as part of the framework bill, I think illustrates what the position of children services is. And, you know, as I said, it wasn't part of the Feely report. We currently spend around five times more on adult social care than we do on children's social care. So the reality is that children's services is the Cinderella here. And, you know, by being on the framework and a bit of uncertainty, we're not sure whether we're going to be invited to the ball or not. And to stretch the analogy a little bit, if we do get a ticket, the music will probably already be playing and it might be a waltz, whereas we'd rather have a disco.
So. Martin, thank you. That's lovely. I know I'm at shortly. Jude Curry, I know you're keen to come in on this as well. Thank you, Martin. Jude.
Yes, I mean, on where, I guess, children's services and in particular, I guess, my role as a practicing social worker, but also representing SASWA, I would say my question is not so much where exactly we sit, but that what it looks like for the functions that we do. So I think it's really vital for the end result of the services that we seek to provide and harness around a family holistically really depends on those functions being together and those functions being that social work needs to sit where those functions are. And when I say that, I mean those resources, the leadership, the autonomy. We need to be where that is. I think the further that we are fractured or distanced from that, I think the end result for the people that we work with day in, day out, I think we heard it in the evidence session last week, sometimes people with 8 social workers over 8 months, you know, we know what doesn't work. Also, we need assurance that what we are moving to is defensible and shows some evidence that it could work, and that we have, as social workers, often sitting in these gaps between services that are maybe unintended gaps, but we sit in those difficult places often and we bring our skills to bear in that. But equally, you know, the Setting the Bar report will tell you very clearly that there's so much stress in the system and distress in the system that I think we really need assurance that the functions do need to work and be sit together and aligned. We do work with whole families. You know, our members, including myself, will work with a whole family network, and that will include engaging with criminal justice, social work, health services, education, housing, all in the one meeting. And I think for every ounce of depleted energy that we spend trying to navigate perhaps even more complicated structures because we're perhaps outside or distanced from what we need, it just takes away from the relational energy we need to be spending to help children and families benefit and realise their rights from those services. So I think that's why it's really key, because it's linked to that and lived experience of the support that we hope to provide. So I feel like it's just that function of social work needs to be really understood on the face of this framework and the face of this bill, as well as throughout the programme. And I think that point about, you know, there has been extensive listening to, you know, the experiences of those who've used adult services, but that question that's asked in Professor Daniel's research group around how do we ensure that children, young people and families get the help they need when they need it, that includes so many different partners, and I think we need to have due diligence and patience to hear what the evidence from those key to delivering those services and experiencing receiving them really tells us. So I suppose we can't assume that, and I think that's why I can feel it's quite frustrating, I think, when you have a framework and people are probably quite frustrated there isn't particular detail that we need. But, you know, a wee example, if I can, you know, many members might be working with a 14-year-old, for example, now, who we know may need that social care support within adult services by 2026, by 2027. But the apprehension that we are engaging with starts now. Our work with that family starts now. So whether we are in or out, it impacts us, and we need to know that our functions will work together for that family and for that end result, both now and later. So it's that apprehension about impending change, I don't think can be underestimated.
Thank you. Can I move to questions from Graham Day, please, because he's going to carry on this theme of integration. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. I appreciate that. Picking up on Martin's comments earlier, I attended an event in Parliament, Convener, last night, in relation to the assisted dying bill, the proposed bill. And the member in charge of that bill has taken an approach where he has a panel of highly experienced medical professionals who have put together a set of proposals that they believe, if taken forward, would ensure that the legislation worked in practice. And I can't help draw a parallel between that approach and the approach that could be taken to this framework legislation, accepting the reservations you have about it. Because if I don't think it's in anyone's interest to have some sort of bolt-on further down the line to a national care system. If we're going to do this, then there is a logic to having young people's services included. But if in that period of research and the period of consultation, there was a very full and genuine engagement with the sector, listening to people who could highlight what's worked, what hasn't worked, what are the barriers. If you had a blank sheet of paper, how would you design a care system? Is there not, on that basis, merit in this proposal?
I think there could be, but it would probably take more time and we wouldn't necessarily be starting from where we are. I mean, I know there's been talk already in the evidence about sort of co-design and what that looks like, and I think somebody earlier said, you know, it's been rather overused. But I think if I could briefly say about how we've done a piece of work in Renfrewshire, working with health and social care colleagues, and I think one of the important points there was we started the process by having a discussion at senior manager level about were we all committed to making changes as necessary, and really the determination was to improve mental health services for children and families. We then went into a consultative process and we held sort of three facilitated focus groups. The first one was with children and families, the second one was with frontline workers, and the last one was with managers. And from all of that, what we got was a hugely complex picture. And out of that, you know, we were then trying to draw solutions. And I think that's the point in these processes. You have to embrace the complexity and you have to listen really carefully first. And you then come to, okay, so this might make improvements. I think the problem is here that we've almost jumped to a solution, and no matter how well done the co-design work now is, you can't go to children and families and say, do you think a national care service is a good idea or not? that's not their lived reality.
But then, with respect, their lived reality in too many places is that a locally delivered and designed and constructed, whatever you want to frame it, a system doesn't work for them. And there will be good examples, I fully accept that. But what we have at the moment doesn't work for everyone.
Yeah.
Isn't the only real chance here, because we heard earlier about 10 years of effort and still nowhere near being where we would all want to be, isn't this the one opportunity we have? However, whatever your reservations about the approach, but if this is taken forward in the way I've articulated from here, isn't that the best chance we have to get this right for children and young people going forward?
I think one of the big problems that I see is the landscape in which we are trying to introduce a National Care Service. And as is often the case with major reforms, you can't choose the moment that you are implementing. But I think just briefly to go back to the reality of the world for children and young people at the moment. You know, we've got a quarter of children in poverty across Scotland. We've got many families who are just coping being pushed over the edge now into the cost of living crisis. We've got existing services that are stretched, and the thresholds of support to families are far higher than the early intervention that we would all like to see. We've got the prospect of further austerity and public service cuts. We've got a retention and recruitment crisis within social care staff. And on top of all of that, we're trying to introduce the promise. And you put all of that together and you say, OK, well, will the National Care Service address and improve things? It doesn't really scratch the surface of a lot of those issues. So I think it would be a huge leap of faith to say that this is the moment where the National Care Service will make a huge difference.
But then, if you look at this from the other side, do you have confidence that as structured and given the approach that's deployed in multiple locations, what's in place will address those issues?
Well, I think what you have to, from my perspective, I've been working in children's social care in Scotland for over 25 years now. And I think we have to remind ourselves that there are good examples mm-hmm. of things that work. And, the committee will be familiar with violence reduction unit, with the decrease in the number of young people in custody. It is a fantastic achievement. Polman is a quarter full compared to where it was. There's good examples of public social partnerships. And we're doing a number of specific, really good pieces of work, which are working now, some of which you'll be familiar with. I know committee members visited our services in Inverclyde. There's also work we're doing in Dundee and Renfrewshire. And that can work under the current system. And I think, that what I would say is that there's, from my experience, I'd say that there's four things that make it work. First of all, a genuine determination to make things better and to deliver change where it's needed. Secondly, that you embrace that whole system complexity. Thirdly, you put children and young people at the centre of all of your considerations. And fourthly, you build that mutual trust and respect. And I think we can look at structures, but again, in my experience, when it works, it's not what agency you come from, it's what you bring to the table that really makes a difference.
But wouldn't a change of structure, or isn't a strange of change of structure, so I'll get my words out, required to facilitate that cultural change that's needed in some places and to ensure that that highest standard, those best examples, become the norm?
I think, as I said earlier, one of the issues here is that health and social care are really important to children and families. There's no doubt about that. But there's an awful lot of other players mm-hmm. in the system. And it, just briefly, the alliance work that we're doing in Dundee at the moment started with education and social work and the third sector coming together to work on improving outcomes. And we very rapidly said, OK, who else do we need to involve? We need to involve health. But then it's also about housing. It's about police. It's about criminal justice and the children's hearing systems. It's about employment support. It's about transport and planning. And the private sector has a role as well. So I think, you know, we could be putting a lot of effort into one part of that system and saying, OK, well, you know, we can get a better alignment here, perhaps, between health and social care. But there's an awful lot of other parts that either are going to be unaffected or potentially disrupted by those changes.
Thank you. Now, Jude, you've been waiting patiently there. I know you've been wanting to come in. So over to you now.
Well, thank you. I think I would probably echo that point about, you know, the key partners that we really do need to make sure that we that won't be disrupted with whatever happens. I don't believe that structure in and of itself creates the conditions of what we need. I think it's the assurance that the relationships that are at the heart of what we do will be safeguarded within a national care service, and that just doesn't come by structures alone. I think we need defensible incorporation of what we know works, and that there won't be additional disruption barriers. So, you know, some of our members will have fears about a potential loss of connection with key council services, whether that's education or housing, for example, our third sector commissioned colleagues as well. But equally, we do see the opportunities as well. I think that's where it's difficult, because we just need the assurances. I think there is the will, and I know certainly speaking on behalf of SASWA, we want to be part of a constructive conversation about this. I guess it's just when the lived reality on the ground is that we already have to navigate complex systems and complex needs within a family setting. And we're already having to have conversations within a multi-agency meeting about, well, sorry, what is the parenting task and which of that adult's needs is a social care need? You know, we try to take and understand those holistically, but our systems and processes ask us to unpick those and direct them down different paths. Now, as social workers, we try to draw those strands together again, and there's so much intent and good intent on the ground to do that. But if we're not given the assurance that what happens next makes that easier, then I think the natural fear is that that will make it more difficult.
Thank you very much. And Stephen Kerr, can we move to some questions from yourself now?
Yeah, so that's an interesting point that Judith just made. I mean, at the end of the and I was very struck with what Martin said about those four issues that you highlighted, those four characteristics. I mean, does anything in this bill do anything for any of those issues that you've highlighted?
Well, I mean, my concern, and I think you've very much had this from the promise as well, is that if we concentrate too much on structure, mm-hmm. we miss an awful lot of other things. And I think, just mention that, you know, the experience around getting it right for every child. And, you know, about 10 years ago, I was chairing the Scottish Government's GIRFEC programme board to implement getting it right for every child. And we didn't get everything right, but some bits of that went quite well. And I think that was because what we were trying to achieve was a cultural change. And what we had was an agreement on the principles and goals across all these different agencies. We worked very hard on a common language. You know, people will be familiar with the Shanari language, which is now, you know, absolutely in all of the agencies. And I think the third point was we came from the child's perspective. You know, GIRFEC's about well-being. It's not about what services are delivered to families. So I think if you put that together, I mean, when we were doing GIRFEC, we didn't particularly look at structures, and we weren't particularly bothered about getting a consistent picture across Scotland. So we got reports back from each of the 32 areas, but what we tended to do was share good practice and encourage people to learn from each other. And I think one of the drivers in the National Care Service and in the Feely report is a feeling that there should be more consistency. And I think that's a really difficult
thing
to achieve.
But it's not dependent on structural change.
is it? I mean, the way you were describing it earlier, it's about people. It's about leadership.
Yeah.
It's about people who take an initiative, who bring other people together, and then work on improving the delivery of a service.
Yeah. And, you know, to my earlier point, it can be done under current circumstances.
Yeah.
But I think, you know, it's having that determination, and sometimes it's also about resources.
So things can be improved.
Yeah.
There's no denying that, and you're making that very clear. But you've also raised the spectre, I think a red flag, actually, about the way that the public sector particularly often struggles with change and the delivery of change.
Yeah.
Do you want to comment on that?
Yeah, I mean, I think I'd go right back to For Scotland's Children, which, you know, was a report in 2001, and we've had over 20 years of pretty consistent policy, which is, you know, I think people feel we have good policy around children and young people in Scotland, and that's been consistent, and we've had it for a long time. What everybody acknowledges is there's an implementation gap, and that is the frustration, that we have all of these aspirations and good intentions, but what actually happens on the ground is not always what was intended. And I think it's that lack of real drive to implement, to improve, and that can happen in pockets at the moment, but we're not sufficiently consistent. And then the other factor is the lack of resources. And I think, you know, if you work in children and families, I always think the acid test is, if this was my child, would this be good enough? And too often, it's not.
Can we bring in Jude Curry, please, on that now? Thanks.
Yeah, I think that's an important test to have. And I do think, you know, looking at the state of our profession at the minute in terms of morale, resourcing, and I guess I would say a degree of weariness. You know, I think we're at danger of losing sight of, you know, why people have come into the jobs and why they work with children and families. And I think structure can help, but it can also hinder. And I think social workers are no stranger to change and change agendas, certainly in the 12, 13 years that I've seen a lot of structural change. But it is those things about culture, it's about language, it's about leadership. And I think, you know, it's important that the social work leadership is understood on the face of this bill and the place of where that sits, because it impacts on practice leadership and retention and recruitment for the jobs that we do. But I do think that point about resourcing, we can put all the structures in place, but if we don't have the resources, many, many times we can look at a plan and, you know, agree a multi-agency child's plan. We don't have the accessibility and readiness of those supports, regardless of where we might sit. That won't work for families, and that doesn't answer that key question of, do families and children get the support when they need it? So it is those ingredients. And, you know, I was at the Children and Families Improvement sort of conference yesterday, and it was core ingredients, a recipe for what families need, that was from research that was stated as family, community, loving care and compassionate services. And I don't think any of us involved in children and families wouldn't look to strive to provide that. But I don't believe structures alone will get us there. I think we've got so many other ingredients to that recipe that I think we crucially, critically need in place. And we need to make sure that the leadership and the people who have the strategic leaders to deliver that for us on the front line and to enable us to sit in living rooms and provide confidence and hope to families really needs to be assured. Think first.
Okay, Stephen Kerr.
Right. So when you talk about resources, and, you know, resources are finite, and particularly money and time, is it wise, given the challenges that were outlined, I think, so eloquently by Martin Crowe in his evidence just a few minutes ago, Jude Curry, that we take up time and money to do something that's basically structural, that will be process heavy, and that will create new and challenging interfaces, particularly in relation to children's services, which will be a small part of an overall service?
Can we go to Jude first? Yeah, sorry. That's fine. Thank you, Jude.
Yeah, so if I'm picking up your question right, in terms of, you know, is it worth the time and resource when those are finite to potentially, I think you're asking the key questions we'll ask of ourselves, you know, in terms of even the fears of what we feel might be an operational nightmare, a cultural nightmare, if not done well. But I think the key part of that is inclusion of everyone who will be impacted by this to be fully consulted and involved and included, including all the complex, you know, complex functions and levers that deliver that. So it doesn't have to be a waste of time, resource that is finite. I think it's about making sure that we are making defensible decisions about that, and that it's not more change for change's sake for children and families. And I think that's why it's really key that we take the time to listen to the research that we need.
Do you want to come in on that, Martin? You don't need to.
No,
you're fine. Can we move now to questions from Willie Rennie, please?
I think Jude just summed it up actually quite neatly there, saying change for change's sake. And I think both of you have expressed very clearly that there are issues, change is required, but structural change doesn't necessarily deliver the change that we require. Let me just be a wee bit devil's advocate, because I agree with everything on that. I think we've had several evidence sessions that have made it clear that the structure is a bit of a divergence from the real challenges that you face. And I have heard about leadership and resources from Jude. I would like to get a better understanding about what that actually looks like and what the changes that we require to make these services better. And then what do we do about it? Because another members of the committee have not unreasonably highlighted that there was a view from some that just leave us alone and we'll get on with this and we'll deliver the change. Now, I don't necessarily agree with that, because I think everybody accepts that change is required. But let me just be a wee bit devil's advocate to challenge both of you to say, what do we need to change and what do politicians need to do to help that? I don't. Jude, do you want to go first?
I would. It's a difficult question, but I'll try to answer it. I think. What do we need? I mean, I think we probably need, as a profession, I think we'd go a long way if we felt kind of represented and understood within this National Care Service programme from the face of the bill onwards. And that is not for that in an end point that we just want that for that sake. It's because we believe that it will deliver better social work and better conversations and relationships with all of our partners and with families about what's needed. So in terms of, and can you repeat the end of your question
It's probably a wee bit convoluted. But what I'm really, it's just wider change. What wider change do we need in the system? Is it better leaders? Is it more money? You know, what is it that you need us to do? Because we're not getting clarity on exactly what it is, you know, the Parliament and government should be doing.
I think autonomy. You know, we need autonomy when we're sitting, and that and I say autonomy rather than a sense of power. I think we need to be able to sit in a living room, as I said earlier, and to feel like we have, and it, you know, it's not heaps of wealth. We know that families come with huge wealth of resources, of of networks that they have. Some do, some don't. But we know the existing communities that we can harness wealth from. So it's not just about financial resource. But we need to feel that what we do have a function and statutory role to access or seek. But we need to know that at the point that we are sitting in the living room having the conversation, that we have the permissions to have those conversations, and that we have the confidence to be able to go to, you know, our managers and leaders, and they have confidence in their managers and leaders that there is influence there to advocate, and that is not lost in a system somewhere. So I think that's why when I speak of leadership, there is that strategic leadership element, but certainly from where I sit and practice every day, it's that practice leadership, and those things need to be aligned. And so all these things, all these sort of community planning and strategic planning, they need to sit together. So that's what I feel, you know, as a practitioner on the ground, I think, you know, that's where it all boils down to, in that good conversation we're having about, but then families feel they've got choice and control, because if we don't feel when we're trying to resolve a difficulty with them as equals, if we don't feel that there's agency there, then we won't. And so it is agency.
So, are you basically saying that you don't feel that we've got your back when you're making some of these judgments, that, you know, politicians and government doesn't back you up when you're making difficult decisions?
I hope I'm being faithful to probably the variety of experiences of our members here in saying it's not that it's about faith and confidence about having our back. I think it's understanding the gaps, like I said earlier, that we often sit in and how we have to navigate those. You know, that they happen sometimes because there are different levers and different agendas that don't align at government level, at community level. They just don't, and we get stuck in all of those, as do children and families. And that's our fear, is that they get lost further in that, and that we get lost with them because we sit with them. That's something I think. So it's about that communication and collaboration being echoed all the way down, and you know that we will be critically challenged and constructively challenged, and we welcome that. But equally, it's that sort of bustle of, you know, what do we need to ask more about here? You know, and what needs to be understood more about how the role of social work fits in amongst all these different elements of the care service? They may not be necessarily involved in all of them, but we often are explaining them, navigating them, and trying to make sense of them ourselves.
Okay. Martin?
Yeah, I mean, from my perspective, the single biggest thing we could do is earlier intervention. The Christie report 10 years ago told us that. It pointed out how much of our resources are spent on failure demand. And in Scotland, we've just had what is, I think, a fantastic review done under the auspices of the Promise, which has said, if we work together, we can take far fewer children into the care system, but that hinges on good early intervention services. We've got the introduction of the Whole Family Wellbeing Fund, which is extremely welcome, but needs to be much more substantial if it's going to actually lead to change. And I think, my feeling is what we really need is a national family support service delivered by different agencies, but actually providing early family support in every community across Scotland. Because at the moment, what we tend to do is we tend to atomise the problems, and we say, OK, well, we've got a problem with educational attainment, therefore we need to do this in schools. We've got a problem around mental health, so we need to do this to support CAM services. And we've got problems with poverty or drug addiction or whatever. And so many of these services come back to, if there had been better early support to families, that would have made a huge difference. So I think, there isn't one answer here, but the thing that I think would make a huge difference is if we actually put in place that national family support. And the committees talked about, where does children's rights fit in with this? I think, the key point for me is we want to be able to say to families, you have a right to the support that you need, rather than, you might get a service or you might not. And if we're serious about having a rights approach, then we have to anticipate that more need will surface. There's an awful lot of families out there at the moment who don't get the support they need. So, having a rights-based service is people saying, where's my service? And the best way you can do that is to have community support across the country that is there without stigma and is very easily accessible, with services coming to families rather than them have to go and get their specialist support from different parts of the system.
So why is that voice for early intervention? Because we've debated that for years. Why is that voice not stronger, and why is it not got to the extent that you would like it to get to? What's stopping this?
I think, and some of the financial parts of the promise were really compelling on this, that actually, if you treat this as almost a capital investment rather than, okay, so how can we just add a bit of money into the system, then you will get a return on that investment. And, people in the past have said there's enough money in the system if you move it around. And that may be true to an extent, but the problem is if you're going to make a big change, what you have to do is double invest sometimes. You have to carry on what you're doing and you have to invest new money. But I think if we invested a substantial sum into early intervention with a 10-year horizon to say, okay, it's not going to pay itself back immediately, but if you did that and actually put in place the measures of how you're going to judge that, I think what you would find is that the return on that investment would come back.
Thank you. Can we move to questions now from Michael Marra, please?
I'm interested in this area you've just been talking about, both Jude and Martin. Is the organising principle of a national care service not the provision of care? But actually, what you've been describing to the committee, the thing this morning, is about keeping young people away from care. And is that not a central culture risk in terms of trying to integrate what you do with an adult national care service? Martin.
Yes. The danger is that if you work in public services in its broadest definition, which includes voluntary sector delivery, that we exist in service delivery land. That's not where children and families are. Children and families have got their problems, they've got their strengths, they've got their supports, and then there's other services that come into the family or that get alongside the young person. I think that is absolutely right. And it does go back to Gerfec. Actually, what makes a huge difference for a child might be a club or an activity which doesn't sort of feature as a care need, if you like. And that's where I think the early intervention comes in. Let's try and actively have fewer children and young people coming into the system.
Okay. Jude, do you think that's a risk about a culture clash?
I think we're at risk of potentially oversimplifying what we mean by care, because I think, and to maybe frame it as something, obviously we want to prevent children and young people entering care, but we need to appreciate the complexity of care needs that might be within the network surrounding that child that may involve, adult social care. It may include a variety of different elements. So I think Martin's point about early intervention is really key, because even though certainly, as a social work practitioner, we're often seen and perceived as crisis interventionists. We're coming in at certain points where certainly I wouldn't like to be coming in. But we do early intervention there too. It's not a chronological thing always. It's a tussle that we're always engaging with. So I don't think it's as simple as, care exists in this forum and, the prevention of care is over here. I think they come often intertwined, whether that's intergenerationally within the family, or it's even within the complex and competing needs of that child or young person themselves. But might be elements of additional need that require a social care element, but equally there's other bits that there's lots of good intervention work that are being supported by universal services. So that's the complexity, really.
Yeah, and that's very useful. I think, would it not be said to be the case that they, in your members, are more and more in terms of reducing resource, lack of partners to refer on to, that actually prevention work has become much more difficult, and that much more of your members' work will be taken up with permanence, issues about referring to care, child protection issues.
And, you know, even that idea of permanence, you know, we want to look at permanence that we do in terms of what does long-term care at home mean? Yeah. And that brings in the promise in terms of, well, what scaffolding do we need? You know, there's routes out of care, not just into care, you know, and so, yes, I think we are, you know, again, the Setting the Bar report will make it very clear kind of what the challenges facing our profession are that we want to move away from. But certainly, yeah, the early intervention profile could be much better. And I think that, you know, I think it was said last week, I think, by Jackie Irvine about, you know, we take risks in social work and we have to do that. And those include financial risks. And I think that's where the trust in what we do as a profession, you know, and as, you know, within the third sector and all the partners, we need to sometimes do that because, you know, even when I first joined the profession as a social worker in 2009, you know, scaffolding is almost like, you know, but we can't stay involved for too long because, you know, we've only got this amount of time, or, you know, that's not a good indicator. But actually, sometimes by staying involved, you know, in a universe or with third sector partners over multi-years of funding that are invested, actually financially works out far better, you know, and it's far better outcomes because it keeps that child at home throughout their childhood. You know, so we do need to take risks in how to be bold and how we view some of these challenges.
But I suppose what I'm getting at within that is that the, I mean, your members will be under pressure to close cases. They regularly are. Your manager's saying we have to reduce the caseload, you've got too many, we have to get... And they, actually, is there not a risk that this accelerates that process? The way that Martin's describing this as kind of the Cinderella service within this process. I mean, we're looking at the figures, if I can. You know, the set-up costs for this organisation are currently looking at about £1.3 billion. That's not money to be spent on your services. That's set-up costs, £1.3 billion. You know, the SDUC and trade unions yesterday calling for this whole programme to be stopped. I mean, that's the situation that your members, Jude, and your service deliverers, Martin, would be walking into. I mean, that feels like a big risk to what you do right now. Martin?
I mean, the situation you describe is absolutely accurate. And... where, you know, we work very positively with local authorities in particular, and what they want is earlier intervention. But a number of the services that we've had running for years were set up as an agreement to be effectively quite an early intervention service for families, and what we've seen over the years is that those thresholds have just got higher and higher, and we're working with not just riskier families, but families who are more mired in their troubles and are going to take a lot of help to get out of that. But I think you can still do things which don't automatically rely on just statutory services. I think, you know, the committee will be familiar with family group decision making and processes like that, which actually identify the strengths and the resources that are available to the family, which enable us to take a more rounded view of it. And you know, kinship care is a very big area of support to children. So, you know, that there are some alternatives within that, but, you know, I'm not going to comment whether it's a good investment or not, but clearly it is a huge amount of money to put into a new structure.
And as part of, maybe to that, Jude, in your reflection, I mean, do your members know that this is happening? I mean, this is, you know, pensions aren't included in TUPE arrangements. You know, there's no clarity on that. Do they know that actually they could be moving employers to a completely new body with no indication of what might happen?
So in terms of our, you know, we've done a lot of work to try and engage as many members and social workers as we can. And I would say that is extremely difficult given when you look at how busy you know, practitioner members really are. You know, so, you know, it has been mentioned, I do hear, you know, we do hear our members probably do hear it, but probably not to the detail that I know we do provide in terms of just keeping people involved and part of this to share their views with us. But the busyness of our work, you know, this is where I think this inclusion and time to understand and make sure that as a profession we're fully informed and fully included, because it's really, like you say, it is really crucial. There are a lot of fears. And I suppose the overarching messages across the variety of views that we have from members are that, yes, there's opportunities, but there's also fears. Yes, as you say, about terms and conditions, about pensions, but there's opportunities in there too to improve conditions for the profession as well, in terms of, you know, even the idea of our mileage, you know, particularly rural social workers driving around, if we are, you know, looked at on par with some of our other colleagues, you know, in health. So we do need to kind of look at both on balance, and I think we try to help members to do that and represent the variety. But I think that's why I think understanding some of the functions and what it costs to provide them is really critical. What we do is too critical, I think, to risk there being less resource put into them. So I think, you know, while, for example, we may keep connections with our colleagues in other departments like housing and education, if we are, you know, feeling depleted in other ways by this, that would also be a fear. There's lots there, Mr. Mara, I think.
Yeah. It just strikes me that I can't see this government doing this to doctors, saying to an entire profession, we're going to change your employment rights. We're going to put in place a bill that allows us to do that and pass it. But they're prepared to do it to social workers.
I think, you know, that's why we want to be constructive here, you know, because at the end of the day, we do want, you know, this aspiration of more accessible support being offered amongst all the other things that make up a life. But, you know, we do need to make sure that national investment can be really helpful for that. You know, it can bring that consistency, but it is about accessibility too. It's about you know, people having that rights across the country. But that also means that we need to be in communities, and we need to be connected, and we need to be forming relationships. So that's a tense line to tread. And I think you're right. You know, I think what we just want is to feel included, and, you know, on behalf of those that we support. So, yeah, I do think the parity issue is an important one.
Thank you.
Thank you. Excuse me, Frog. Thank you very much, Michael and Jude and Martin, for those. Can we move to questions now from Ruth Maguire, please?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, both. I had some questions around structure. I think we've probably covered that pretty well in answers, both in terms of the importance of leadership and culture versus structure, but also I hear Jude loud and clear when she talks about her members being depleted of the structures that they have to navigate around are taking more energy than the job itself. In terms of leadership and culture, one thing we didn't talk about there was accountability. And I suppose I would have a question for you both in terms of what risks and opportunities you would see around children's services, the accountability for children's services moving from local authority to Scottish Government ministers. I'll come to Martin first, please.
I think, with due respect to local government colleagues, accountability to many of the families we're talking about is pretty low currently. You can put in place, you know, if there was a national care service, you could be more consistent about complaints procedures and all that sort of thing. But I think if you said, OK, we have a national health service, how accountable is that to the families who we're dealing with? Again, it's low, you know, because accountability is important, but, you know, if you're struggling to get the services and support you need, you know you don't stand back and say, how can I realize my accountability here? So I think
I'm using politician or policy making language. Yeah. There does making people, you know, realizing people's rights, that's what we're going to be in the business for. Can you see opportunities in that chain of accountability, I can't think of another word to use for it, being to Scottish Government ministers rather than to local authority?
I think it would have a different flavour. I was talking to somebody at Police Scotland, and, you know, bringing all of the forces together meant that there was a closer focus on Police Scotland as an entity in the whole. But of course, what that means is that the issues and the problems that were covered by 8 regional forces are now all the responsibility of one body. And I think, you know, as we see with the NHS, an issue has to be pretty big to, you know, to sort of hit the scale on that. So I think the advantage at the moment is that if there's a child death inquiry or whatever, you know, that is dealt with at a local level and hopefully those lessons are learnt. But if we had that on a Scotland scale, it might sort of shift some of those thresholds.
Okay. And Jude?
Yeah, I mean, I think, we're accountable and, I guess, answerable to our codes of practice as social workers are, and we've got a code of ethics. Now, we also are accountable to our statutory functions. But in terms of, under law and what we do, I think accountability to the outcomes for families, I do think, we'd have to hold our hands up and say, we need to do better and could do better, but we need the conditions to do that. And I do think there are advantages at times to having sort of national oversight, and I guess investment in terms of training, understanding, awareness, governance of certain aspects. But I do think, that can't come at the loss of local connection and local accountability. So it is that national and local sense of checks and balance. So again, accessibility of complaints, how do people voice what's going well and not? Can they do that within their communities and within the relationships that are around them, or do they have to try harder to seek those out? Those are the questions that I'd like to ask.
Okay, thank you. If I could stick with Jude, I wonder, reflecting on the change that we had with health and social care integration. Obviously, there's risks in any change. There's, as well as being opportunities, there's risks. Reflecting on that change that's already happened, what do you think are the sort of short, medium and long-term risks to families and children, I suppose, in accessing their services?
The short, medium and long-term risks of accessing services from the experience of what we have of integration so far. Certainly the views of our members will be mixed because not all will have that experience. Some will, some won't. Personally, I haven't, but I do think, and so I guess if there is bits of this that I feel I can answer afterwards, Ms. McGuire, we'll do that, because I do think, it's an important question. I do think, the benefits are gained from better communication, less, and maybe better understanding about, at times, GDPR, things about how we share information, the ease of sharing information, maybe challenging the fears around doing that, I think can be a short and medium term win. I think also what we learn from each other's professions is definitely potentially a long term win for families. I think when we have a shared language, again, you'll look at some of the kind of shared language that GERFEC achieves over a period of time. But when you have certain services that have to work closely together and are governed more closely together, you maybe have more opportunity to build on that. So I don't want to, I don't want to say too much because and overstep kind of what my own, what I could recall myself from that, but certainly we could approach members to ask more specifically, because there will be. I think that's the thing, in both structures, that the child and families exist in, there will be pros and cons. But I also think there'll be, in terms of implication for children and families, I think it just could be that are we looking at things holistically and looking at a community base, not just health, I don't know. I think it's that balance between, a medical and a social approach that needs a balance. And, we need our leaders and managers in those structures to understand so that we as colleagues can work well and understand each other's worlds. Mm-hmm. But I think there's a benefit there, but there's also a lot of challenges.
Sure, that's helpful. Martin, do you have any reflections on that?
Well, not so much on that. I was just going to come back to your accountability point, because I think, you know, an interesting issue is about, so what metrics do you use to hold national services accountable? And there's always the danger that what you focus on is what's relatively easy to measure and is, you know, bald figures. And the example I'd use is CAMS waiting times. So, you know, we have a very specific CAMS waiting time, it gets reported against, and, you know, if it goes down, we say CAMS is doing better and so on. Actually, you know, the experience that we see on the ground is that it's not so much about the waiting time, it's the fact that when families actually get to the front of the queue, in some areas of Scotland, the majority of families don't meet the criteria. So they've sat on a waiting list for a substantial period of time. That's what gets measured. But actually, for them, it's much more devastating that when they get there, for various reasons, they don't get a service at all.
Thank you. And will your organisation have reflections on the risks, looking back at integration of health and social care?
I mean, as I said right at the start, I mean, in all honesty, it's kind of passed us by. The focus has been very much on adult services, and we see some good examples where there is a greater joining up. I think sometimes some of the sort of substance misuse areas, it's made a positive impact, but it's been relatively minor in the scheme of things.
Okay, thank you, convener.
Jude, do you want to come in finally, just before we close the session? Thanks.
Yes, I always try to think of practical examples that maybe come to mind when the questions are asked. And I think, again, it's not a structural thing, but a relationship thing. You know, in working with CAMS, often we can't eradicate the waiting list, as you say, you know, that exists. But certainly I've had personal experience of just the good relationships we can have around consultations, about being able to understand what we're still having to engage with live and make sure that we're still being responsive. It may not be the response that we would hope or strive for, at that point of need for that child, but certainly in terms of understanding each other's worlds. And so that's what I mean, you know, regardless, you know, between health and social care colleagues and also, ourselves in a local authority setting or wherever, you know, we do try to still try and find those solutions. And we will keep doing that.
No, thank you very much, and thank you both for your time today. The public part of today's meeting is now at an end, and we will consider our final agenda items in private. Thank you, Jude, and thank you, Martin. Thank you.